Hello and welcome to a new episode of the Game Informer Show. I'm your host, Ben Hansen, joined by Kyle Hilliard down at the end.
Hey.
Oh, you sound so good.
Oh, God. I feel so healthy right now.
We just have booger face
going on. Aren't you guys glad I came in today?
Yeah, we made him sit over on the far end there.
Yeah.
We got Andrew Reiner here as well.
Hello, Ben Hansen.
You're welcome to take that hat off, sir.
No, it's too late now. I got headphones, man.
All right. Then we got Joe Juba. You're welcome to take that face off, sir.
I'm doing my best.
Great.
Sorry. Oh, yeah, okay, here I am.
All right. We got a hell of a show here, folks. We're getting out of the gate talking about, finally, it feels like a lifetime, finally going to talk about that Final Fantasy 15 trip we went on.
Yeah.
Just for a frame of reference for how long ago this was the week that we posted the Pokemon Spectacular. The reason we did that Pokemon Spectacular is not only because the three of us love Pokemon, but because we needed to bank a show so that we could fly out to Japan and I still have a GI show go up. So that was the week that we were on that trip. So we're going to talk all about that.
Yeah, that was what? Early March that we went, I think.
Was it? End of February?
Yeah, end of February, early March.
Yeah,
which, for context for everybody, is like much earlier than we get ahead of cover stories usually, right?
Right.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
So we're going to relive those memories and talk about, you know, the opening hours of Final Fantasy 15 that we played and kind of give you the highlights of some of the interviews and stuff and talk a little bit more about the month of content that we're rolling out for Final Fantasy 15 because it is a 15-centric month.
Yeah.
And now Joe doesn't have to lie like he did last week on the Game Informer show.
I did not lie, as a matter of fact. We can talk about that later too. But this isn't it for Final Fantasy related podcast stuff either. We're going to do like a special edition, like question, you know, we answer your questions or whatever segment, right?
Yes. So that we'll tease that at the end here. So there's going to be more opportunity. I think we're going to have Kim on for that one. She can make it to this one to talk all about Final Fantasy 15. But not only are we talking about 15, but we're also talking about Hyper Light Drifter, which is a game Kyle recently fell in love with madly, truly, deeply. Ratchet and Clank with Andrew Reiner.
Hmm. What?
Do you have a tally for what number Ratchet and Clank game this is?
I think I told Joe this is my 13th or 12th Ratchet and Clank review. So I went back and like read all of them.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, you always have to do that.
How many times do you use the word charming and Pixar-like?
12.
Okay, perfect. Great. But you like that and you love the hell out of Hyper Light Drifter.
Yeah.
So there's a lot to talk about before we get to emails. There's some fun ones there. And then before we get to the back half of the show, too much content. We got Lauren Lanning on the podcast. So it was a long chat with him, and you might not know that name, but he is the creative force behind The Odd World, the king of the world himself.
I was going to say the protagonist from Bayou Billy, but that's not Lauren Lanning.
That's Billy.
Ah, that's right.
Big mouth bass. So we talked to Lauren all about basically what the Oddworld Inhabitant studio, it's this confusing situation where, like, you know, they have this small studio that owns a license, then they kind of contract out other developers. So talk about just kind of the state of things for them, their pseudo remake of Exodus that's coming up, which I think everyone assumed is going to be like the new and tasty treatment, which he's saying it's much more than that, that they're actually adding, kind of revamping the story a little bit, making it darker.
Speaking of new and tasty, did you talk to him about Sugar? Because way back in the day, their studio director, I cannot remember this woman's name, but did not allow like sugar in the studio. So everybody had to have like tasty like vegetables and fruits and sugar-free stuff in there.
Oh, boy.
I wonder if that's changed.
From the look on Hanson's face, they had an extensive conversation about this.
45 minutes of the talk are about sugar.
That's probably why those games are so depressing.
Why they're about like soda and stuff.
Right. What's the name of the race? Mudokons?
Mudokons.
Mudokons. I'd rather eat a Mudokon pie then go without sugar.
But we also Mudokon Pops, actually.
That's true.
Yeah.
So we also talked to him about who he considers to be the smartest developer in the industry, or one of them. And he talks about his conversations with Shuhei Yoshida about the PlayStation 5. So there's some interesting stuff in there. And a lot of film talk as well, because he's kind of in between the worlds, and he's worked a lot with Hollywood. So especially if you're a movie fan, stick around, because he's a smart guy that's been around forever. But now, let's talk about Final Fantasy 15, Joe.
Yeah.
Once and for all. Here we go.
It felt so good to be able to like reveal that cover, because, you know, like as a fan, I feel like we saw a lot of really cool stuff there, and it's kind of hard to sit on all that until the big reveal sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely. So last week we talked about the cover a little bit, but now we can actually dive into the trip and everything we saw, stuff like that. Just right out of the gate, I want to talk to people, because I saw a lot of comments with like the first video feature that we posted, which was an interview with Tabata about the game's opening chapter, first chapter, I suppose you should frame it.
Yep.
And there were a lot of people that were shocked by how rough the gameplay footage looked.
Yeah. Despite the fact that there's a big, like, it says pre-beta gameplay on it. Like,
yeah, we put that label on there. It is not polished. It is not the final state of the game. It was absolutely amazing. Maybe it's just being a video guy, but I was floored that they let us capture as much as we did. We were rolling for hours, and a lot of it is very, very rough. Not to say this is how the game's
going to
ship.
Put it all online.
Yeah.
No, it's just like...
Put it up.
People always talk about how they want more transparency from companies and want to see games in development, and then it's like, hey, here's a game that is not in a polished state by any means, and everyone freaks out thinking it's final. And it's like, you need to accept that games are not done until they're done, everybody. So,
and here's one thing that I actually want to point out about it is that, like, some people see this as sort of like if they look at that footage and see it as like a warning sign that the game might not turn out.
Right.
Like for context on our end, that's actually a good sign, because like if there is a studio that is confident enough in what they have 5 months out from release to like let a worldwide outlet like us actually just like record without restriction, basically, and just like use that B-roll in our videos and stuff, like that's a sign that they're confident in what they have and what it will be as a final product.
Even though
it currently isn't there.
After you played, were they like, guys, what'd you think of that? Like,
no.
Actually fishing for real info, and you guys were like, oh yeah, it was totally cool. And they're like, all right, I guess. Call it done, guys.
Let's finish. Let's just stop working on it.
We're done.
Exactly. Yeah. They love it.
So a lot of people were curious about the state of the game, like whether or not English dubs were in the localization.
Yeah.
Like all that. The opening cutscene was in English, and the rest was in Japanese, including like a lot of it. There wasn't even text on the screen. It was so early.
Yeah. There was some like debug text and things like that. Yeah, I mean, like there's definitely a case of like us having to use our imagination to like put some things together, I think. But
sounds like a game in development.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's it's almost like there's still several months
to
go.
And it's a big, huge ass project that they're working on.
And I should say, I mean, I do want to clarify too. Like, I don't want to use there's still 5 months to go as this sort of like universal cure all that forgives everything. You know,
right.
like I understand. I'm not saying that the game is like guaranteed to be fantastic, you know?
Right.
Like there are things that can go wrong, but a lot of the things that at least I personally am like seeing people commenting on are things that are well within the realm of possibility to be like polished between now and release.
Absolutely. There's going to be a whole realm reborn before the game comes out, for Christ's sake. But you talk about, you know, geeking out going on this trip. I'm just curious, out of the gate, what was your biggest geek out moment, Joe?
Oh, man. I think for me personally, for someone who's been a fan of this series and its art for so long, like actually getting to sit down and talk with, like we did an interview with the artist Yoshitaka Amano, who for the people who don't know, did a lot of like, he's the one who does the sort of iconic logo illustrations, those kind of like silhouette things. And then also does, at least for some of the earlier games, did like character illustration.
Yeah, so he's not an official Square employee. He's just contracted out by Square, but he has like his own art studio out in Tokyo that we took a cab out to, and it was kind of coupled our interview, or Joe's interview specifically, with Tabata being there as well to get approval on some of the art they're going to be showing at the Uncovered event.
Right. So yeah. So that thing that they showed, that kind of like 3D, that 3D animation of the logo, basically. Mm-hmm. Was something that while we were there, they were kind of sitting down and hashing it out with Amano. I don't know. It was in Japanese, so I didn't get a step by step of like everything that was being discussed.
But it was fascinating watching Tabata interact with Amano, and Amano's like taking out his pencil and like drawing sketches, and like, oh, I think it should be more like this. He needs to kind of wave like this. It was crazy. And also just the atmosphere of that place. It felt like an art museum. And then Tabata came in and was like making everybody crack up a little bit with jokes, but it felt very serious and tense before that.
Was it his art studio, or did he have his house attached to that as well?
I don't think he lives in there.
Because I went to Todd McFarlane's studio, and it was basically a room above his garage.
Okay.
Huh.
And so that's where he worked. It felt like an art gallery.
Yeah. It felt more like an art gallery / museum that, I mean, I guess there could theoretically have been an apartment there. It wasn't it was in kind of a mixture of like a residential commercial kind of area. So.
Yeah, but there'll be some pictures going live with Joe's interview, which is going to be going up in the rest of the month. Do you have a date in mind for that? Is that just...
I don't remember off the top of my head.
Okay, but coming up in the next month. There's a crazy detail there where the way he framed things was really interesting to me, where Amano at some point in your interview said that he thinks of the Final Fantasy characters the way that Andy Warhol thought of Marilyn Monroe. It's just a way to like express himself, which I thought was a bizarre, interesting point. Kyle, what are you doing?
I'm raising my left eyebrow because I find that point to be interesting.
Are you a Final Fantasy fan?
No.
But
Kyle is best Kyle, by the way. I love this guy.
I am excited for this game, which I've talked about on previous podcasts. Like, even though I'm not a fan of Final Fantasy, the whole concept of like road trip RPG is really cool. And I played through the demo with my daughter. Like, I just let her play, giving her very little direction. And
is this Dust Sky or Platinum?
Platinum.
Okay.
Yeah. And she really enjoyed that, and I really enjoyed that. And ever since that day, every day she comes home, she's like, is that game ready yet? Can we play that game yet? And I'm like, we got a ways to wait, kid.
You're really going to break her heart when you realize that you don't play as young Noctis in the actual game.
Yeah. But I am, for those reasons, like, I am excited about this game, despite not being a Final Fantasy fan. It seems interesting to me.
Well, we should talk about what we actually played with this thing. Joe, you want to just set the ground for what we saw, what we played?
Yeah, so what we played is what they're calling Chapter 1, which is essentially what seems to be the beginning of the game proper, but they do reference a Chapter 0, which without getting... They didn't talk to us about specifics in terms of, like, who exactly you control or what you're fighting during
that. It's in some setting they haven't revealed yet.
Yeah. But they led us to believe that the opening of the game will be some sort of, like... I mean, Tabata likened it to the beginning of Final Fantasy II, the original one, where... You
don't need to tell Kyle. He understands.
Yeah. No, so not.
Oh
not,
yeah, I totally got it.
Not the one.
So it'll just be a page of text.
Not the one. Not the one that was Cecil and the Red Wings in that, but like actual like Famicom 2, where the game, like, you name or like you start the game and you just immediately get into a fight with like some Dark Knights and they kill you and then the story proceeds.
It's from that
there.
Classic JRPG or RPG thing where it's like you're in a fight but there's no way to win it right out of the game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So just sort of like a cold open sort of thing, and then. Something happens there, but then there's a cutscene of Noctis leaving his home city of Insomnia in his dad's car,
saying goodbye to daddy,
and then sort of heading off with his friends to go get married, and then that's when Chapter 1 sort of starts, and that's where we picked up.
Right, and there's a whole interview if you go to the hub, which is gameinformer.com/FFXV15, where Tabata like lays out exactly what's in Chapter 1. But I mean, how much? God, from the capture, it's like 2 hours maybe for Chapter 1, somewhere around there?
I mean, I feel, it's like probably 2 or 3 hours. And then we also played around with, and there's a video with some of this content on there too, whereas we played around just like in a sort of, not a playground here, but just sort of like an open area where we could just play with a more evolved version of the combat system.
It's a debug battle arena, basically. Not in the game, but just like, hey, we can summon a monster somehow, and you can just battle it to get a sense of the variety of enemies and stuff like that.
Yeah, because where we were at in Chapter 1, obviously the full range of like combat options wasn't there.
Right.
So this was a way for us to get a peek at sort of what a more evolved version of the system, you know, later in the game will play like.
Yeah.
So
Chapter 1, was that just pretty much a linear run-through, or... was there like a mission board you came across, anything like that, like a hub?
Yeah. Kind of, yeah.
You said yeah to all of
them. Yeah, Reiner asked you like three separate things.
No, I think they're all correct. I mean, there is a hub. So your Hammerhead is kind of the name of the area. Is that the name of the gas station specifically, Joe?
Yep.
Okay, so that's kind of the hub-ish thing for Chapter 1. But you ask about how linear it is. It was interesting because Kim was playing right next to Joe. And she ended up taking a slightly different path, and I'd look at both screens, and Kim was deep in some dungeon somewhere while Joe was kind of making progress with the main story. So it wasn't a linear open world in that arena.
Yeah, I mean, think of it... So the team is actually sort of hesitant to compare this to a lot of, like what we would consider traditional open world, like Assassin's Creed or The Witcher or GTA or whatever, because, like, it's not... It's deliberately a more... linear or story-driven like mission experience, but the world is open in the sense that you can go and like explore different corners of it if you want. But it's the idea isn't to like not to like do it Witcher style and overwhelm players with just like side quests every few steps.
Yeah, and like I feel like that's what's been kind of confusing. It's 'cause I feel like I don't know how much of this is the press versus Square's positioning of it, but it's very much been like the open world Final Fantasy, which I feel they're even doing a little bit for Lightning Returns. But Tabata in an interview. Was very deliberate. Like, I don't want people to have the wrong impression. Like, this isn't really open world. It's just Final Fantasy with more freedom than you've ever had before. But don't think of it as like a classic open world.
Yeah, I think I think part of the way he describes it is like open world is the technological backbone for it.
Sure.
So they want to create in an open world that like all of this stuff exists in, but open world in terms of the way gamers understand it as like a, you know, okay, so it's open world. So you have all these districts to conquer and all these collectibles to get. And all, like, I don't think that's really an element of it. But with that being said, there are side quests and stuff that you carry on or take on. So like while I was at Hammerhead, I go up and I like walk to the counter at some diner or something. And like one of the options is like to do a monster hunt nearby. So that's the sort of thing where it's like, hey, there's like a named monster. You take that on. There's a named monster nearby that you like go and beat, and then you get a reward for it.
You want an apple pie, a cherry pie, or you want to go on a monster hunt? Welcome to the diner.
Yeah, it is a little bit like that, I think.
What was the biggest surprise, Joe, in playing the opening hours?
For me, I think the biggest surprise was the combat system. That, like, after playing Episode Dusk, I was a little bit skeptical about the way that would pan out.
Totally. Because I think we talked about it feels a little bit mushy mashy.
Yeah, or just sort of like it feel like in Episode Dusk, it felt like I was just holding down the button and slowly just kind of watching my guy attack and chip away at health, and it didn't feel very engaging to me.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas like in the version we played, it seems like they've responded to that in like they heard that criticism from people. And it seems like they've responded to it in several ways. One of them is making like the way you switch weapons more active. So it's like instead of it being like weirdly tied to different maneuvers that you could pull off or whatever, you just sort of like select, I'm using a sword now. I'm using a great sword now. I'm using a gun now.
Or switching to this magic spell.
Yeah. So you're actively switching to what you're using. So that gives it a fun sense. And then I think the other thing that struck me about it was that, like, I don't want to give the impression that this is a like highly technical, precise game like Devil May Cry or Bayonetta or something.
Yeah.
But I feel like visually that's what they're going for. You know, that it doesn't play like one of those games.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of exaggerated, over-the-top types of action.
It has, like, your character's doing flips, and there are all these, like, special effects, and there is a kind of stylish flair that goes alongside with, or that is presented with the combat that reminded me of those games. I'm not saying that it, like, looks exactly like them or that you're pulling off combos like that or anything, but it seems like they were going for that sort of, like, impressive, stylish effect thing, even though the system itself felt much more like accessible and maybe a little more tactical.
Which, I mean, it didn't feel night and day different from Episode Dusk Eye to me. I mean, did it to you?
It did. To me, and I mean, it might be a factor of a few things, but like I said, in Dusk Eye, it felt like the enemies had too much health and you were just sort of chipping away at even like sort of stupid dogs or something like
so
that.
So many,
you
know, stupid dogs. More than two stupid dogs.
Yeah. And like to me the balance felt better worked out in the version we played and was more engaging to me. It felt like I wasn't spending as much time just sort of like doing the same moves against the same thing.
Yeah.
So. One of the things for me, I love what I've seen of the combat. I haven't played it, but got to see a bunch of it here in the office.
Sure.
Prior to the cover story trip and all that stuff. But Even in the trailers, there's such a contrast between these guys being such badasses and toppling giants and dragons. And then there's just that weird moment where your brain just kind of shuts off when they're pushing the car. Like, they've run out of gas on the highway. Talk to me about that element. Did you get to explore the driving? Can you, like, drive off the road under the mountains? Is there stuff like that?
Yeah, that was maybe the biggest surprise to me was the driving. I mean, we drove a fair amount. Number one, from what I saw, like, don't expect some intricate network of roads. Like, these continents have like one or two roads going along them. So that kind of leads to it being a little bit more, linear.
I think that might be oversimplified. Like, there's more than one or two roads, but it's not like a city where it's just like,
totally,
there's a road going, like you need to be judicious about the way that you're, I mean, actually using The Witcher 3 as another example, the way the paths in Witcher 3 work.
Yeah.
Is kind of like what the roads seem like to me there.
In a similar way, in that they really want to keep you on that road. Like, the car is gravitationally tracked onto the road. It kind of has a pull, so you can break free, but
it's not, you're not on rails, but it's, you also, at least from what we played, you don't have the degree of control over your car that you would in like GTA, where it's like super easy to just like veer off the road and go off-roading and start like going up cliffs and stuff like that. The car kind of wants to stay on the road.
Yeah, if you really want to get off the road, you're going to have to fight it.
Where's my really potential disaster button? Where did I put that then?
It was surprising. I had no sense of that going into it, that it was trying to keep you on the road that much.
Is that just
a
debug thing, or is that
No, I mean, it could change before release.
You could fly the car everywhere, it looks like.
Right, you certainly can.
Yeah, I think part of the idea, and again, like, I don't know for sure, but like from talking to them, they definitely want the players to feel like they are part of the world and have a sense that they're like appreciating the world. So maybe the idea of like the ability to have the car sort of handle itself on the road, so you're not worried about worrying about second to second staying on the right path. If you want to rotate the camera around and like look up at a big monster or look up at the mountain or something nearby.
And you can set it on auto as well, so it just drives from one place to the next.
Right. I like that, but
because, well, like Ben said, you can get off the road.
Right.
I did. I mean,
I have plenty of footage of Joe ramming into rocks monsters on the side of the road. Yeah, it's a thing. It's a whole thing.
I don't want to give the sense that it's like on rails, but yeah, the car definitely feels like it has a predisposition to staying on the road.
That's right. The Regalia is alive and it desperately wants to stay on the road.
Yeah.
That was a bit of a shock. Also, just like the amount of time, and I think later on they said that you can skip this through some upgrade or something along the way, but the amount of time between like driving from town to town was a little bit shocking, where it's like there's like the kind of beach area called the Quay, that's kind of the second larger-ish area that you go to outside of like the Hammerhead gas station, and just going from that place to that place, like there's a fair bit of time where you're just listening to this techno remix of the Final Fantasy theme as it's going from town to town. Did that strike you, Joe?
Yeah, I mean, it didn't strike me as a bad thing, I guess. And I feel okay. Because like this is making it seem like I'm just like, yeah, whatever they're doing is great. But like, I guess what I'm saying is like, I see potential in that. I see the potential for that to be tiresome. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Fast travel?
But.
Well, the answer is you can skip it eventually at some point.
But I think there's also a sense of like, if what they're aiming for is that like sense of a road trip, I think it's important to like have the players be on that trip for part of the way. Journey.
Well, and it's nice the characters are animated, like they'll get up and move around the car and stuff.
There are times like even though it's a stretch of driving that even if you can't skip it, you're driving and like Prompto is sitting in the front seat and he turns around and like all of a sudden there's some like, you know, some chatter going on with like him and Gladio and they're having some conversation and
right.
Yeah. Rockstar's so good about that. Like whenever you got to drive to point A to B, like in a mission, they will have commentary most of that track. Yeah, and even if you die, they'll have a different commentary track.
And this was the toughest thing to get a read on in this demo, mainly because it was in Japanese and also because it was unfinished. But trying to get a sense of like how much character banter and bickering there was tough at this point, because there was some in there for sure, but there were certain sections like, oh, I wonder if they're going to plug more dialogue in here. Did that strike you, Joe? Did you get a good sense of like the characters and the relationships starting out?
Well, I mean, like it was in Japanese, so it's kind of hard to see exactly how all of that's going. I only have to go on what sort of they told us. So.
Yeah. Traversal, though. Another thing that stood out to me is you talk about going on like that monster hunt in the beginning, trying to track down the monsters. Like in the beginning, and I'm sure obviously it changes later, especially when you get chocobos, but there's a fair amount of like running around that desert area around Hammerhead and running around, and there is a sprinting penalty?
What?
Yeah. So this is... So basically you like hold down a button and you can sprint, but you can't sprint indefinitely.
Okay. That makes
sense.
You're
not big boss.
Yeah. So, you know, there's the only problem with it. I felt like was that there's no, like at this point, there wasn't a clear indication of like when that meter or like, you know, when you were going to tire out.
Mm-hmm. It just reminds me of Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah. But the other thing I'll say about it though, is like we raised this as a concern while we were there and after the trip, one of the guys on the dev team reached out and was like, we're working on a solution to that.
Oh, really?
Thanks for the feedback.
I didn't know that. It was maybe one of the biggest bummers. Like, oh boy, sprinting penalties. Come on. What is this adding?
There's
like
going to be a big alarm in the game now where it's like, running out of breath.
Yeah, exactly. That's really what we're hoping for. So I guess just as far as the overworld, that was striking to me is just how it's like, oh, it is kind of more classic Final Fantasy quest and stuff, just kind of stretched between these expanses on the road where you're driving around. And I think the realization that it's not your typical open world game was my biggest takeaway from that gameplay experience.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, and this all comes back to a question that Reiner had earlier, and so like how linear is it? And mm-hmm. I think it's got a like a lot of open world games, it has a linear main quest that you can follow that will take you through the important beats. But if you want to go off the beaten path like Kim did during her playthrough, where she like went into these like mines, there's like a dungeon there.
Yeah.
That like you can go off and explore and like, you know, explore other parts of the world, to me in a way that felt, I mean, they're different generations, so it's hard to like totally draw the comparison, but like it reminded me of that sense of like in the old like super NES and Super NES games, or even like PlayStation, the PS1 games, where there is a period of transition from one beat to another. You know, it's like you go from Midgar in Final Fantasy VII to Calm, and there's 5 minutes or so of like walking from place to place, fighting things along the way. You're not picking up a ton of quests here and there.
So just
you just have a goal on your horizon and you're sort of traveling.
And now you're just in a convertible with a bunch of yahoos.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That's the difference here this time around. Like other stuff we saw like a lineup of some of the monsters they're putting in the game. And we're not going to spoil anything. I think fans will be very happy. Yeah. With the lineup here.
One thing, this was kind of funny. I saw on some forums, I guess like shortly before our issue hit, Tabata was doing another interview with someone and they asked about Tonberries. And he was like, Tonberries are not in the game. Even though we specifically, like in our feature, we specifically called out, like, we saw Tonberries.
were Tonberries.
Are those cactus dudes?
That's Cactar.
Come on, man.
I'll see myself out.
They're the creepy turtle men with the hoods and the stabbing.
I don't think I know what you're talking about.
There was one on Tim's desk when he was here.
Yeah, they're all over the place.
Good riddance, Tim.
Saw one in the game.
Saw one in kind of like in the engine.
Yeah, so here's, what we can say about that is that like, I mean, obviously, whether or not a monster, like Tabata knows better than we do whether or not a monster is making the final cut in a game.
So, right.
Like, I guess, like, we can't promise that.
We'll just say that's from Final Fantasy 16.
But we absolutely, in this, like, sort of like in-engine, in-game, like, monster gallery, saw a Tonberry.
Also, talking about biggest geek out moments, I'm not saying at all what it is, but Joe is a pretty cool customer on Cover Story Trips, and he saw something in this monster gallery that made him go, if I can do a Joe impersonation.
Yeah.
Oh man, he lost it.
That was a really good Joe.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I think fans can look forward to that stuff. And as Tabata pointed out, there are a lot of fans of Final Fantasy V and VI on this team. And so if you're a fan of those as well, you might have some surprises coming.
Hey, Joe.
Yeah.
We won't let these people know. Just whisper it in the microphone what it was so I can hear it in my headphones.
This is a direct Reiner microphone.
Oh, okay. Yeah, great. Here, yeah.
Whatever. Perfect. You talk about seeing things in the engine. Another interesting thing that I learned that I didn't know on this trip is I thought this was still considered the Luminous Engine, which is how it's all labeled online, but they said it's not technically the Luminous Engine anymore. They worked on it enough and tweaked it where it's not officially labeled
they
the
just
Luminous
changed the
Engine.
Name.
Correct.
Yeah. I mean, you treat that like some big revelation. I feel like I
like engine talk.
I feel like that was known a long time ago.
Really?
That's not some big thing that came out of this. Yeah.
Really? I really had never heard that. Like even on the Wikipedia page for Final Fantasy 15, it still listed like Luminous Engine, everybody. I don't know. It's interesting much they're like.
I think some of that might be confusion because like I'm sure at one point Versus 13 was using the Luminous Engine.
Sure.
So maybe without some sort of formal name of like, this is the new engine we're using, it maybe just didn't get properly, you know, like maybe the information wasn't dispersed properly or clarified, but like.
And the way they frame things talking about the engine, I mean, they were talking about, I was like, oh, we just want to develop this tech possibly for the future. So it seems like in theory, they're planning on bringing it into the future. But as Tabata pointed out, no sequels for 15.
Yeah, no 15-2, but the future Final Fantasy games, possibly.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Other big takeaways from the gameplay?
Yeah. Well, one thing I wanted to point out, there's a video up on our site, an interview that Ben did with Tabata about sort of like incorporating fan feedback and things like that. But one thing I want to like stress about this is that like I understand the skepticism that a lot of people have about this, like for a game that's been in development for so long, for people who felt slighted by, the 13 games.
Absolutely. Yep.
And I think that there are a lot of, there are a lot of people out there now who are like, their interest in 15 is diminished because of like how long this game's taken and the direction the franchise has gone in like the last 10 years or so. And probably like my biggest takeaway from the whole trip is that like they understand that.
100%.
They own up to it. The team on 15, like, gets why people are dissatisfied and they're trying to do better.
That, again, yeah, it was huge. Just, I mean, we talked about it 1,000 times on this podcast. I love Final Fantasy VII. I love all of them up to 12, basically. and I really fell off with 13 and even with 15's development. I mean, for so long following this thing, it's just been like, okay, I guess. But hearing how brutally honest their read on the state of the Final Fantasy brand is, it's like, they could not be saying better things as far as like, hey, we understand what fans want. We understand exactly why they're disappointed. And also, I feel like there's kind of this new era of transparency at Square. I feel like Kim wrote a feature about it with Yoshida, who's kind of the director of Realm Reborn with 14, and then Tabata, the director of 15. And it seems like those two have kind of, it feels a little bit like a cultural renaissance within Square is the vibe I got. And it seems like a lot of it came from realizing 14 was a disaster Yoshida even put it, he's like, it's not even a game. And now they've turned it into, quote, a fat pillar of business for Square, which I like that wording a lot. But going from that and trying to reboot that and just realizing, like, we need to be completely honest and open with the fans. And I feel like that same kind of rebooting mentality has very much carried over to 15's development, going from versus 13 and even beyond that.
And, like, it's uncommon. I mean, you guys know this, too. It's, like, it's uncommon for any studio to own up to a mistake like that of a previous
game. Oh, yeah.
Yep. You know, like, we've seen, even for a game, like, I remember when I was doing the Dragon Age Inquisition cover story.
Oh, yeah.
And, like, there are just some, Dragon Age 2 was a game that I actually enjoyed a lot of, but there are just some sort of unequivocal problems with that game. And even then, like, there were some people on that team who were, it's not like they were denying it, but they certainly didn't want to go on the record, like, talking about the problems that game had. You don't want to throw your previous project. You don't want to throw your friends under the bus.
But they can kind of allude to, like, we've been listening to the fans. Right. Like, we're pushing a little bit more in this area. But this is very much like, hey, we understand. Like, again, check out the interview on fan feedback with Tabata on the site now, where it's like, we understand, like, this could be the demise of Final Fantasy. Like, this is make or break. Like, 15 has to knock it out of the park.
Yeah. And it's rare. Like, so what I'm saying is, like, for any company, it's rare for them to acknowledge that from a past installment, and it's especially rare for a Japanese company, I feel like, to do that.
I mean, are you feeling optimistic about 15 at this point after your time with it?
Yeah, I mean, I do. I really do. But, you know, like we said, there's a lot of time left, and
not a lot.
Well,
September 30th, right?
Okay, September 30th, but I guess I think about, like, the way, a good example would be, like, the way the original Uncharted felt to me, like, at the E3 before it came out, which was like, it felt like really rough to me.
And then you saw the potential, but it was like, it wasn't right where you wanted.
Yeah. And then just like 3 months later, that game came out. And, like, I mean, the original Uncharted is, maybe not as good as the later ones, but, like, it really came together in those last few months. So, like, there's definitely the potential for this game to, like, use these remaining 5 months and, like, really come together.
Yeah, that's one thing to point out. Every dev team approaches their game differently, and the state of polish things go through and passes and stuff like that. So we don't know how they're approaching it, but hopefully it comes together.
Kyle, what's your read on the core problem with the Final Fantasy brand in the year 2016? And I'm not going to allow you to make a joke answer. Like, sincerely, what do you not want from 16?
What do I not want from 16?
Yeah.
Wait, 16 or 15?
I'm sorry, 15.
15?
Jeez. Okay.
This is a weird question for me. I mean, I guess, like, the sort of going overboard with the sequels, like, and licensing Lightning out. Like, I went to San Francisco recently for, like, Microsoft Build conference, and they had big billboards of Lightning holding, like, purses and stuff like that. And it's just like, what are you guys doing, man?
So no matter what, you don't want a broader universe with Final Fantasy 15? You want it to be focused to just one game?
Yeah, I think so.
That's hilarious. I have bad news for you, Kyle. They're making mobile games and animes and movies. Is that different for you than the idea of sequels?
Yeah. Because so you can ignore all that stuff.
Okay.
I guess, like, I don't know.
You can ignore the damn purses, too.
You can ignore the damn purses.
Kyle can't ignore a purse.
Can you really ignore, like, Final Fantasy 13 2, though, if you want to take in that whole world? Like, in 13
I ignored 10 2, I guess.
Yeah, I mean,
it just seems like oversaturation.
Totally.
And I think that's the big thing. I mean, but 15...
Well, and there's a cash grab element that people are wary of, I think. The idea that, like, oh, this is popular, so let's just churn out something to capitalize on it rather than, like, let's do something that is, you know, with some sort of degree of, like, artistic intent.
Yeah, I think for me it just comes down to, just, I don't know if it's a matter of, are you guys overthinking it over there? just simplify and give me a good story. Like, it's a weird example, but I always think back to it. Like, in the same night years ago, I started replaying Skies of Arcadia and played the first 2 hours of that game, and also started playing Final Fantasy 13-2 and played the first 2 hours of that game. And it's like, one got me excited for an adventure with friends that I'm meeting along the way. That's all I want from Final Fantasy. Get excited about an adventure with some friends that are interesting characters.
Yeah.
And it's just, I haven't had that experience for so long. And I hope that they can get that out of the gate. And I hope that the English version of that opening chapter will convey that more.
Yeah, they have a unique hook there, especially for Final Fantasy. But just that idea of this road trip, as weird as it sounds and as disastrous as it could end up being, have fun with it. Understand your audience. That's a big thing, too. If you want this to be a Western title and be a hit in the West, embrace that. Make sure you have people paying attention to the narrative, all that stuff over there. Don't have it be like 13, where I learned most of the game in loading screens.
Yeah,
like most of the plot.
For something so talky to not convey anything, that's my big problem with the Final Fantasy.
Okay, I feel like you are unfairly holding this game's feet to the fire based on the fact that it was in Japanese and you could understand a single word.
I'm talking about specifically with that, with 13 is what I'm talking
about. Well, I still feel like it's applying for 15 in the way you're talking. I was like, I hope they convey it more. Well, yeah, being able to understand the language will probably help.
It's a fair point, Hansen, because 13 was a narrative disaster.
Yeah, it's a fair concern, but based on what we've seen so far, we can't say one way or the other whether or not this game is doing
that. He's just speculating, he's hoping.
Right. I guess maybe with 15 specifically, then burrowing into that, it's weird and a little bit maybe off-putting to me to have like the four characters right out of the gate. Like, I like the slow trickle of introducing characters, where it's just like,
it's
understand.
It's just a preference. Like, you love Paper Mario, where you build out your party.
Yeah, like, that's what you want them to do. Just drive to their house and pick them up.
I would like a nice introduction of each character along the way, instead of like, to learn these characters' backstories, watch the anime that we're releasing free on YouTube. That's kind of the bummer to me, I guess.
I will say, I played about 60% of Final Fantasy 13, the first one, finished it. I feel like I already have much more understanding of where the story is going in 15 than I do 13.
That's good.
Like, I know Noctis's motivations. I know he's got a special relationship with his father, and he's going to marry somebody, and something goes wrong there. Where 13, that's like, I was like, there was a big crystal in the sky at some point, and Lightning told her little sister not to date the Troy Baker or something.
That's right. I think that was 13-3 then, where the Troy Baker storyline.
And then you bought three purses. That's going on.
Here's the other thing that's weird. It's like, in Final Fantasy VII, you start out with Cloud, Tifa, and Barrett. I mean, like...
Tifa takes a while. I mean, a little while before you get introduced to her.
It's the two guys on the train. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Starts on the train.
It's still Avalanche. You have to understand right out of the gate.
Yeah. Like, all things being said, like, you start with a group there, too. And you just accrue more people.
But you're not accruing more people as far as we know. They said there's going to be like some special guest characters swapping in and whatnot, but I don't think it's going to be a matter of you start with four, then you get up to 16, right?
Yeah, I mean, I assume so. Yeah.
Anything else you want to talk about with 15 before we move on?
No, I think that covers that's a lot of it.
But again, send feedback to podcast@gameinformer.com for the upcoming episode. We'll also have a post on the site where you can leave a comment and whatnot, but this was one where we'll have Kim in a more of a special edition format. Like we did it with Metal Gear back in the day, where people write in questions. We talked about that we had played with Ground Zeroes.
Yeah, so we can address, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, fans out there, like we did before we saw the game, like have a lot of questions about how it is, and there's obviously stuff that was just like, you know, kind of, we didn't get every last detail into that cover story. So
absolutely, especially like, you know, just the other interviews we did, we're gonna be rolling out a lot of that onto the site and in our hub and whatnot, so stay tuned for that. But there's a ton more to talk about Final Fantasy. But for the love of Christ, we should move on to something else.
Yeah, it's been a long chat. Sorry, everyone.
All right, let's talk about the Final Fantasy 15 anime that they released, Joe. So what are your thoughts on the first episode? Let's get to Hyper Light Drifter, because I felt bad we didn't get to that last week.
You should feel bad.
Kyle?
I was in the thick of it last week.
I know.
With Hyper Light Drifting.
I'm sorry. Tell us about this game and how it changed your life forever.
It's real good. It's from Heart Machine. They did a Kickstarter, actually, but the sort of interesting thing about their Kickstarter is they didn't have like a notable developer on their team. Like most Kickstarters are like, hey, I've worked on Mega Man, but you want to watch me make something kind of like Mega Man?
I've changed my legal name to former Mega Man developer.
Exactly, yeah. But this was just like, they had like a little trailer with like a really awesome soundtrack from Disaster Piece. I don't know if, actually, I don't know if that initial trailer had Disaster Piece
in it. But the game does.
The game does, yeah.
Disaster Piece being the person who did music for like Fez and the movie It Follows.
Yes. Okay. And it's and that was all they needed, because the game just looked really cool and they got it going. And the final product is great. I think I gave it a 9.5, which I think is the highest review score I've ever given that Game Informer, maybe.
Oh, could the be highest this year, next to XCOM 2, both 9.5.
Yeah, man. Like it's certainly my game of the year so far.
It seems very much up your alley. Like I started it, and it's like, oh, this is more Fez than Zelda than I realized. And then I just imagined Kyle licking a television
screen. It is funny because it's like, there's a little bit of Zelda in there. And then I really love Fez. That was my personal game of the year, whenever that came, 2013 or whatever. Yeah. So like the soundtrack really appeals to me. It's just like they just said like, hey, let's make a game for that guy. Over at Game Informer, he likes cool action games and open world. I love that it's those sort of like pixelated games these days are so often roguelites. I was so excited that this is just like a straight action game. The combat is awesome. It's a lot of quick movements because you have like a very quick dash. So it's a lot of moving around enemies and getting in and getting out really fast, like dashing in. Swipe with your sword, get out, maybe fire off a shotgun, move to the next guy. And it can be really tough. I'm surprised at how much people are talking about the challenge, because it is a challenging game, but I thought it was pretty forgiving because the restarts are very nice. Like it's not like Dark Souls where you run in, maybe you die, and then you get kicked way back and you lose all your experience.
Sounds like you've also been playing Dark Souls 3.
Okay. Yeah, I got to compare it to Dark Souls a little bit,
That brings up a question for me, though, because like I feel that like a lot of times, Dark Souls being as popular as it is, I think people tend to draw parallels to it all the time.
We should stop doing that.
Totally agree with you.
And unnecessarily. Yeah. So like I guess my question is like, in this case, are those fair parallels to draw? And if so, like how? Or... Are they not? And let's just stop talking about Dark Souls.
The sense of discovery, I think, is certainly there. The combat is different. The challenge is different. But like the sort of ambiguous world that you're exploring and opening up kind of has a Dark Souls vibe. Like it's the same sort of emotion of like, oh, what is this place? What have I found? Do I want to fight that thing? That thing looks scary. Maybe I should leave that alone and try to go somewhere else.
And how much of that is the lack of English text? Because that was the thing booting it up. Like they have like
lack
some
of text.
Prompts.
Period.
Well, there we go.
Yeah, like there is like a couple things that's like, hey, X is your sword. Mm-hmm. But after that, everything in terms of the story is just the most you get is you talk to certain characters and they'll give you like three pictures of maybe what happened in that section of the world.
That's cool.
Yeah, I really like it a lot. There's like when you go east, there's like this sort of flooded area. And you talk to these white sort of bunny like creatures.
Oh, my favorite.
And it looks like, and the pictures they show you are these frogs just like massacring them. And so you just get a sense that like these frogs came into this world and just wiped them out. And you're just kind of there picking up the pieces and seeing what happens. And then there's also these huge titans, like these like robotic titans that have just like seem to have like expired, like maybe they've been there for hundreds of years. There was one that was like submerged in water. There's one that looked like it died trying to climb up a mountain.
Are those the things in the beginning, like with the big heads? And
yeah.
Whatnot? Okay.
It reminds me a lot of Nausicaa, the Miyazaki film Nausicaa. Which,
nice. Quit bringing up Miyazaki. Trying to get away from that comparison.
This is the other
Miyazaki humor, everybody.
That's a good one.
It's it kind of feels like Nausicaa a lot because of the Titans, but also because it is a world that is like way far ahead of like there was some sort of technology in the past, and then it seems like maybe the world built up and then crashed again and built up again and crashed again. There's just like, and there's no explanation for any of that stuff because there's no dialogue or anything like that. It does a good job of selling an emotion of kind of this dark world as opposed to saying like, hey, here's exactly what happened. It kind of reminds me of the storytelling of Limbo a little bit, where you can acknowledge characters. Uh-huh. And like you can see that things are like you kind of have a vague idea of what's going on, but you're never going to get like solid answers.
Did this game also just feed you mac and cheese and show you family pictures from your childhood? Yeah. What other ways did it court what you're interested in?
Yeah, this is all my favorite things.
It's also
red hair.
Kyle is a huge Limbo fan.
Yep.
Also,
yeah,
the biggest fan of Limbo.
Like Miller described it, which I liked. He called it kind of like a tone poem. In a weird way,
it's classic Miller.
It's like, which
did you just
I liked.
Turn around and walk away?
No, I nodded profusely. I was like, "You're right, Miller."
But how long did it take him to say that?
He beat it. So like, we had like three discussions about it before he arrived at that.
Okay, all right, good.
Sun to moon, Miller talking.
Check it out if you like that type of thing.
Yeah, it's on PC and Mac right now. It's coming to consoles some vague like next couple months maybe. Okay. But it's really good. I really like that game a lot. Really awesome action. Really cool world. Lots to discover.
It's very cool. That's a good word for it.
It is very cool.
It's got a good style.
And I will say, the last thing I want to say, because I'm sure I'm going to move on, is like it does have that sort of pixelated art style.
Right.
But the way it does colors, like it really feels distinct. And I really like the way it looks a lot.
Yeah. I mean, in a similar vein. Oh, Joe, go ahead.
I have a question about it. Just because, like, so I like ambiguous storytelling stuff. Like, I like putting the pieces together. Mm-hmm. But once the pieces, like, once I have some pieces together, I like some confirmation. Like, I like to know if that's right or not. Is there ever any any chance, do you think, that Heart Machine will come out and be like, okay, everyone, like, let's say in like 3 months, they're like, okay, we've all played Hyper Light Drifter now. Everyone's curious. Here's a little story based in this world, or here's something like something to give people maybe something more stable to base their sort of theories on.
I don't know. It's tough to say what they'll do. I don't know. I would guess probably not.
Would you be interested in something like that even?
Or do you like it? While I was playing it, I actually haven't done it yet, which is funny. But while I was playing it, I was eager. I was like, oh, I can't wait to go online and see other people's theories about mm-hmm. what's going on here. But in terms of like, hey, here's exactly what happened from the people that came up with this, I would be fine with that.
What's your limit there, Joe? What do you want? Do you want, like, Ueda to come out and be like, hey, here's what's going on in Eco. Here's how it's exactly connected to Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm not talking like I want a whole novel that, like, ties this stuff together.
You don't want to read that Eco novel?
No. Okay. But, like, I guess I'd like to know. It's always interesting to me to see what connections are right and which ones are not and what things I might have overlooked.
Is this personal validation?
No. It's not about that. It's about, like, I like to be comprehensive in just my understanding of something, you know?
Yeah. No, so, S. I've seen the way you played Stardew Valley.
Yeah.
It's like you just poured the entire wiki into your eyeballs. It's absurd.
So, yeah. I like being a completionist about things. And, like, okay. Like, I appreciate ambiguous storytelling for, like, the tone that it conveys. But after that story is done, mm-hmm. I like the opportunity to sort of, like, know definitively.
You just don't like possible. You go to a gallery and you're like screaming at artwork.
Well, yeah. What does it mean?
Wait for his Amano interview where it's very literally, hey, tell me about the logo to six. Explain exactly what this cryptic thing is.
I just want all art to be text explaining what the intention is.
I just want to see a headline involving you of man yelling at artwork.
Well, hey, talking about quick action, though, I want to quickly give a plug and a shout out to Enter the Gungeon, which came out last week, the week before. It's doing really well on Steam, and I'm kind of burned out on roguelikes, but I booted it up last night after being a little bit too frustrated with Dark Souls 3. What a delightful game. That art style is so good, and, like, it all has this bullet gun aesthetic. So many of the enemies are based on guns or ammo and the world itself, and it's just incredibly satisfying to run through this roguelike and, like, flip tables up and, like, hide behind it. If you're sick of the roguelike genre but are looking for something with some quick action, check out End of the Gungeon.
Yeah, the first time
or
I heard it
as... Hyper Light Drifter.
Yeah, but Enter the Gungeon's easier.
As a Star Wars fan, when someone said it to me, I was like, Enter the Gungeon? What the crap is this?
It's a video I rented once.
It's like Inner Space, but with Jar Jar Binks.
That's exactly it. But hey, we should talk to Andrew Reiner now, everybody.
Yeah, let's do it.
Finally, star of this show.
Down
if
in
you're
front.
Not watching the YouTube version, right. Reiner threw a cup. You know what? Let's not talk about...
Yeah, let's just skip Reiner. Yeah,
Ratchet and Clank 4.
Okay, here we go. Ratchet and Clank, the full reboot.
Mm-hmm.
Insomniac... I feel like, tell me if I have a weird read on this, Ratchet & Clank seems like the type of series where people are nostalgic about it and saying, God, I really want them to make another Ratchet & Clank, yet it seems like one comes out every 9 months.
Yeah,
am
it's
I
every
alone
couple
in
years.
Feeling
yeah,
that?
There's it's been around since 2002. It is this kind of odd survivor from this era where these anthropomorphic beings were all the rage, and yeah, he's kind of one of the lone survivors that really... is there every year, like you're saying, like there's a kind of a weird diversionary game or a straight sequel or a new trilogy or something that they're doing.
And now this is the gritty hardcore reboot that gets to the bloody core of Ratchet and Clank.
It's a remake of the original game from 2002, but it's also kind of a sequel where they're doing new things and have new content. And it's also a movie adaptation game. So it's like all three of these things amalgamated into this weird Frankenstein with fuzzy fur.
Is that
going to
feel funky? Like I never finished
the
original.
It does, yeah.
Okay. And I haven't seen the movie yet, obviously. Does it feel just caught between worlds in that way?
It kind of does. Yeah. You get this kind of feeling of deja vu if you've played the 2002 game where you're going through it and you're like, I remember this train, but the train's different now and the track is different and it's, you have this weird connection with it or the name of the worlds, or you run into Big Al, you know, this character from the series, and you're like, oh yeah, Big Al, but he's maybe saying different things and maybe he's the model from the movie now, where they have this kind of parody between all their the movie universe and the game universe. They're using different assets, sharing them back and forth.
But if you didn't know the movie existed, would it be jarring? Are there like ads for the movie like popping up at the end of the game?
There is a talk. There's Quark makes a joke about the movie at the beginning of the game.
Well, doesn't
he kind of breaks the fourth wall a little bit? Okay.
I thought the game actually has some movie footage in it, too, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, for the cutscenes they use
sometimes
the movie.
Or yeah, and the model in the game is the model from the movie, and yeah, there's weird stuff going on.
Man,
but it is a super fun. Like, if you like the Ratchet & Clank series, this is a worthy successor. That's the best way to put it. It is lots of fun. Weapons that are over the top and crazy. They still have that knack for making weapons you haven't
seen
before.
Don't use that word.
Oh, knack. Sorry, Mark. Cerny. The Pixelizer, there's this new weapon in the game called the Pixelizer. Turns into the Pixelizer HD, where when you shoot an enemy, they pixelate. And it looks very retro, and it makes
so cool.
Like Space Invader sounds. And then when they die, they explode into, it kind of looks like little Minecraft blocks.
Yeah.
Or the Pixels movie, which nobody saw, you know, just the, in the real world, it kind of looks kind of crazy because the game is gorgeous.
Yeah.
Absolutely stunning.
I feel like Ratchet & Clank HD, it seems like that remastering just came out. So even if you played through that, this feels different enough where people should go back to it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so. Yeah. There's enough new content there where you're like, oh man, that was a cool new level, or the way they changed this one was really exciting. Even like, I can't remember the name, Kerwin, that might be the name of the planet, where there's this challenge tower that you have to ascend. And you, in your mind, you're like, oh, I remember this. But then you go back and watch it on YouTube or go play the HD version, it's like, wow, they completely changed all the jumps in that. That's cool.
Hmm.
So yeah, I think it's a, really quick, it's a fun game. I couldn't put it down. Like, I was just having a blast.
I'm really in the mood for this thing. Like, especially, maybe it's just because I was turned off once again from software game, but like, I just want a cutesy platformer. And the last time I tried playing a Ratchet & Clank, it made me really nauseous on PS3. And so I'm hoping that...
Why is that?
I think
it's
it was maybe...
a third-person action game.
I know, but it was running at 60 frames, possibly. There was something about
it. 30
that really,
frames. It's like locked 30.
Okay. Joe, do you have that issue where 60 makes you more nauseous than 30?
No.
Because I know we share nausea. We're nausea brothers.
Yeah.
But no, I'm excited to check this out. I really want to play it on PS4.
So here's my question about it. Mm-hmm. Is that I haven't really played a lot of the Ratchet & Clank games.
Sure.
But, you know, working here, I sort of get a sense of the enthusiasm for them. And I feel like it was really high in the PS2 era.
Yep.
And even though they've been continuing, I mean, like you say, he's sort of a survivor. I feel like awareness of Ratchet & Clank has been sort of lower.
It's always been there, but it's just kind of like for the hardcore fans. Kind of like Mega Man in the late 90s,
but also it's
right?
been so many, like, Tools of Destruction, I feel like they got out of the gate on PS3 with something where it's like, oh, this feels like a new Ratchet & Clank. And then it was like, well, here's a smaller version, kind of using some of those assets. And then here's a spinoff with kind of some tower defense things.
And
here's
did they
all
do some
one.
Episodic? Some, like, episodic?
They were kind of adventure games, some smaller thingies.
So yeah. Anyway, so I guess my question is, like how does this one stand up to the last few entries? Is this, like, does this feel like a new beginning, like a sort of shot in the arm for the series?
Yeah,
or is it just another Ratchet & Clank?
It's both. Kind of like the game is everything. I mean, like I said, it's like a well-worn glove, you know, glove bomb, whatever it is in the game. But at the same time, it feels like it's not breaking new ground by any means, but it is a fun new path for it to go down and a great new take on the origin story where I want a sequel. I want them to do Going Commando again.
Oh my God.
And redo it and go all the way down that path.
People at Insomniac are jumping out of the office windows at this point.
Do you really, it's a good thing they're on the one story building.
I thought this was like a love letter and then like finally wrap this baby up. Let's move on to something big and cool.
No,
I mean,
I hope
a thousand different projects.
I hope it takes off. I hope the movie is a huge success and Ratchet's bigger than it's ever been. And I want more of these games because, I mean, there's magic there. There's something really fun with what they do.
Okay.
There's a reason it's stayed around since 2002. People buy them. People play them, obviously. They're profitable. It's not just going to be this hole they're throwing money in, right? Like, these games, people want them. And I want another one.
Wow.
So hopefully we get it.
All right. Great. Well, I think that's a good place to leave it for games. Do you guys want to read some emails?
Sure.
Let's do it. And welcome back to the Game Informer Show. We got some hot, hot, hot emails from the community that people sent to podcast. Wow. podcast@gameinformer.com. And so at the end of this, we're going to choose our favorite email.
Number three.
And send about something nice. Oh, good choice. Great choice. Starting out, Andy writes in and says, hi, just a quick note saying goodbye.
Andy McNamara? Is he done?
Oh my gosh. He says, I've gotten too old for games and I'm going to retire.
Wow.
We'll package up my consoles tonight and ship me off to Amazon. Games just got too long and too complex and there isn't room for me anymore. Wish you all the best. Thanks for everything, Andy. All right, bye, Andy. The gaming industry will miss you. We don't know what that email is about. Thank you. All right, moving on.
Wait, Mike, what is going on here?
I don't know. A guy named Andy just wrote that in saying, I'm done with games. All right, bye, everybody.
Well,
you know,
well he's not going to watch this, so... Okay.
Maybe he will if he wins Question of the Week.
Yeah, dude.
No, that's kind of interesting, though. I've heard that... I've heard that from a lot of people.
Wait. This is not Andy McNamara.
No.
Okay, just a guy named Andy who's done with games.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. No,
I just think games are too long and too complicated, Joe?
Not the whole packing up and I'm quitting thing, but just the idea that, like, you know, as you get older and you, like, have more demands on your time, you don't have whole weekends all the time to, like, throw into gaming necessarily. I've heard of people who are like, nah, it's too much. I just can't keep up with it anymore.
With Kyle and I, with a daughter.
Mm-hmm. We share a daughter.
Shared daughter, yeah. it's weird how we conceived her, but
tell me more.
It's tough. I mean, it really is hard to keep up. Like, when a game like Witcher comes out, you're super excited about it, but then you, like, sit down, you swallow hard, and you're like, oh my God, mm-hmm. how am I going to play this? Yeah. You got to start planning, like, I'm only going to sleep 3 hours. I mean, seriously. I mean,
wake up early, set my alarm.
Yeah, you have to do things. You have to find ways around that schedule. You can't, like, not have your daughter time. You got to have that. Yeah. And then on top of that, and that used to be your game time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And for people for whom that, like, this is not their job, those sacrifices might just not be worth it. I mean, like, I can understand it.
Yeah,
unless you play with your kid. Kelly writes in and says, hello, GI crew. Thanks for a great show each and every week. Thank you, Kelly. I have a 4-year-old daughter who enjoys playing video games with me. We got Disney Infinity 3.0 and she absolutely loves it, but the story mode is way too difficult for her. I agree. It's confusing. What are some great kid-friendly games where the difficulty would be suitable to my 4-year-old?
If only there was someone equipped to answer this question.
Joe, do you want to talk about your dog or something?
Stardew Valley.
Oh, yeah. I guess the answer is Stardew Valley. Now, what do you guys think? You both
How old's your daughter,
girls?
Kyle?
She's 4. She's
what?
4.
What?
The Final Fantasy Platinum demo is very good.
Interesting choice.
She really did enjoy that a lot, actually. I was surprised. I'm trying to think of what...
What, like, about, like, Minecraft?
Minecraft is 2 analog sticks, which she can't do yet.
Okay.
So that one's... I did try that, but she couldn't do it. She couldn't do 2 sticks. She likes, like, Jak and Daxter, actually. Like, a platformer where the camera's usually, you know...
Following?
Fixed. Yeah.
Also, like, God of War?
God of War, she likes a lot.
Ratchet and Clank, doesn't... I don't know.
Those shoulder buttons are tricky for a 4-year-old.
Absolutely.
Disney Infinity we enjoy.
Oh, really?
We play that a lot, yeah.
My daughter, 3 years old, doesn't really get the challenge yet, but loves watching Unravel. It is. Oh, she calls it cat game because he looks like a little red cat. She thinks it's the funniest, just the cutest thing. Like, she's always wanting to play it, like, all the time. Non-stop. Like, perfect. Pretty much she comes home like, cat game? It's like, no more.
Play other stuff. Audience for that. But Joe, going to your point, Carrie writes in and says, so I bought Stardew Valley after hearing you all talking about it. Love the game. My fella fell for Penny, just like Joe here. Yeah. No regrets there. Now my 10-year-old daughter is playing, and she has wooed Alex the Jock. Should I be concerned? Guess it could have been worse. She could have gone for Shane.
Or the weirdo who lives on the beach.
Oh, Sebastian?
Yeah.
Or Elliot.
Are you
is that like Captain Ron?
Yeah, no, but imagine Captain Ron combined with, like, the Beast in man form from the end of Beauty and the Beast.
Or Fabio.
Yeah, that's probably a more relevant example.
Go for him.
Yeah. Are you going for, like, a podcast record for, like, consecutive mentions of Stardew Valley or
Absolutely.
Something?
Absolutely. Well, like Joe is nearing the end. I sold my soul at the very end of that game to the Juba Mart, which I'm very excited about.
Juba Super Values.
I got,
actually,
like,
a thing.
Got an inch away from finishing off that game in the clean way, and then basically it's like going full Paragon for all of Mass Effect, and then, like, at the very end being like, renegade to the core, baby. It's pretty hardcore. So I sold out the entire community center with one package left.
Nice.
Yeah. But Joe, you're still in love with that game.
Yeah,
right?
I did it right, but I'm almost done.
There we go. But speaking of Stardew Valley, Jake Z writes in. No. But he gets to a point that Kyle brought up earlier. He says, why do people like pixel art games? I think they're ugly. What's the deal? I agree. I'm sick of the pixelated art style.
It can be. There's bad pixel art and there's good pixel art for sure. But there's still. I still love it. Just it's nostalgia. You know, like, it still. It looks and feels like a classic game. Like, I feel like I'm playing a game that I missed during that, like, Super Nintendo era.
Do you ever feel like it is not going the lazy dev angle, but a little bit of developer cop out, where it's like it'll look a little bit cheaper if they go for something like that?
Just development cost is cheaper.
You think so?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think there's still a giant range of the quality of the art and everything, but I always wonder, like, if they didn't have the pixel art nostalgia crutch, I'll say. Like, how good can they make
fair,
that game look?
By the way, yeah. To call it like a crutch, because there's a certain amount of, like, you know, it is cheaper to do it, and it looks cool, and it feels like a classic video game, you know, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's also something to be said for like, just the level of familiarity with something like that. Like, it kind of ties into nostalgia, but like, I don't feel it as being like that, I don't know, like exploitative or something. Like, mm-hmm. not the idea of like, hey, people love pixel art, let's do pixel art. But there's something as a player that, like, when you're playing a game that is in that style, I'm not necessarily playing it going like, oh, this reminds me of Super Nintendo, that's so cool. Uh-huh. As much as it's just like you just immediately fall into a rhythm, like things. You understand the way things look because you've seen things like that before, and like you already have a kind of visual vocabulary for a lot of that. So, like, in a lot of ways, that can, if you're like, I'd say for a game like Axiom Verge, which comes out on Vita next week, mm-hmm. That actually, like, using that sort of familiar visual vocabulary makes it easier to access as a player and like play around with the innovative things that game does, because like everything around it you think you know, so that means the things that you don't know stand out and like pop all that much more.
There's also a mechanical advantage too to pixel, like when it comes to like, you know, like platforming or something
pixel
like
perfect
that. Yeah, like there's a reason like Donkey Kong Country, which is like sort of rides that line of like not really being a pixel game, uh-huh. why it's not like super great about being like hitting specific ledges and stuff like
interesting
that.
Interesting point. Yeah. I think that's fair. I love the trend though of people being nostalgic for art styles outside of the pixelated. Like, I think Devil Daggers is a good example of that on Steam, where it kind of goes for like a Quake 1 kind of look, or like the Shovel Knight developers have talked about how much they want to make a Shovel Knight 64 and just have it be like crude polygons and awesome. 64
that
style.
Would be cool
awesome.
To see that.
For a lot of people though, like obviously we grew up with this stuff. For a lot of younger gamers though, it's just a different art style for them, right? Mm-hmm. Like, so it's just kind of weird for them at certain points where it's like, why is this shooter just blocks?
Well, thank God,
pixel junk shooter. Like, what is right. this?
Thank God for Minecraft kind of reintroducing a retro look to the entire younger generation, so they aren't too
turned
off.
Yeah, it's just a different look. Yeah.
Yeah. Here's a question, Reiner. I think you should tackle this one because you're an expert. Good evening, gentlemen.
Baseball.
Reminds me of a Simpsons quote, which you'll understand, Joe. Can you define gameplay without using the words game or play? This word has always seemed strange to me. I have yet to hear a movie critic talk about the great movie watch in the latest blockbuster, or a Goodreads.com reviewer praise the book read of a New York Times bestseller. This is Michael from the Mitten. So define gameplay without using the words game or play.
So, okay, yeah, like interactive entertainment.
But saying the game has good gameplay, I think, is where he's getting at.
I can try. It is the aspect of the player, but like the interaction between the player.
You can't
and
say
the
play.
Oh, you can't say play. The user, is that cheating?
That sounds too
corporate.
It's character.
No, it's the act of like pressing buttons and their interaction on screen and how it responds. On
responsiveness.
Screen. Yeah.
To me, it's the intersection of a lot of different elements. That would be.
That's your definition of everything.
No. Seriously, because like.
Space-time.
To go with user, it's the intersection of a lot of different elements that create the user experience, you know? So okay. It's like how it feels, how it looks, how responsive it is, and like whether or not it's fun.
No.
All sort of tie into that.
So all interactions.
I am a good work
like
guy.
Those other examples, like watching and reading, like are passive experiences. Like you're not necessarily interacting with them. So you can just sit back and sort of see it happen.
Or are you Aaron Blair talking about that kind of high level video game talk?
No. That's a really good point.
Yes, absolutely. All right, here we go. Chase Smith writes in and says, Ben Hansen's, that's my own name, admittance to being a huge baby about using Oculus Rift alone got me thinking. What is the scariest VR game scenario each of you can think of? His example, which sure, Chase, is would you play a VR game alone where in the game you're in a home knowing that a murderer is going to break in and attack you, but you don't know when or how, and your only weapons are items lying around the house, but if you survive, you get a cash prize? Thanks for your feedback. Sweet dreams.
You know, that's a great idea.
That reminds me of the first Scream movie with Drew Barrymore's character in the house where she gets that phone call and then you see him kind of darting from room to room. Absolutely terrifying. The best part of that movie.
So you want a VR game with a phone call and then just finding someone's in the house?
Well, just, yeah. I mean, that would
that would be absolutely terrifying, especially if you go down into like a, I don't know, a moist basement or something, or, you know, like up into a, like a dirty attic or something. I don't know.
Are you making callbacks to the off-air conversation?
Moist basement, dirty attic, messy living room.
Musty recliner.
I mean, kitchen.
These were all...
That would be terrifying. That would be absolutely horrific.
Yeah.
Anything on top of that? Wow.
I think...
Because you're in your own home. You know, that's... You're comfortable, but there's something in there. We've all had that moment where you're in your house alone and you hear something and you kind of panic, right?
That's
you
every 15 up. Minutes of
yeah.
my life.
Yeah. See, yeah. for me, I think there's a difference. Like, I think that game, as being described, would actually be like a fun, good horror game. Like scary, but good. For me, the idea of like being actually like disturbed or like genuinely frightened by something, I think for me would have to be something like a car wreck simulator or something like that.
Oh my, like watching geez. People around you die?
Yeah, like being like a VR game that like puts you in a car wreck would to me be the thing that would like make me like scared or sick in like
I'm getting
real.
Scared just thinking yeah. about yeah. that.
The other one for me would be, you know, like the home is that kind of unknown element that you're scared of, right? Like what's gonna happen. But like Saw, I think those movies were pretty brilliant in that you knew the rules, you knew the time, and having that timer tick down and then something horrible happening would be terrifying in VR, I think.
Yeah, oh, like a drowning game or something.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's the room's filling with water. Oh, or
I guess Adrift does that a little bit, don't they?
Like, yeah, you run out of air. Yeah, but it's
for sure.
What about a game where you're scenario, standing on a really high ledge or the edge of a building and there's just someone just running at you like full speed?
All right, well, this is exactly where I'm going with this, which is like Anthony Gallegos, who's a developer at Gazillion. He's on Rebel FM, the podcast I've listened to a lot. He was talking about how there should be a VR game because there's, with a sense of presence, when something like big walks in your close to you, it feels weird. It feels like it's actually intimidating.
It's awesome. Yeah, I love it.
And so he came up just off the top of his head of a game called Personal Space Invaders, where it's just rows of humans slowly marching towards you, and you have to try and take them out, but they're just getting closer and closer to you with like this blank stare on their faces. It is so terrifying.
Just breathing through their noses, or breathing through their mouths.
They can just
really
look like
heavily.
Corporate business people, but just slowly walking towards you. And it's like when they're getting close, it feels like they're really like
they
right
like
up in your
Jesus
business.
And you get more points
yes.
the
pockets.
Closer they get. Is that kind of the thing? Because otherwise, you're just going to flail and they're never going to get close to you.
Also, I had the ideal VR game. I want this more than anything now, but I was recently in a mysterious place with a lot of museums. And I don't know if this is an unhealthy urge within me, but every time I'm in a museum, I just think and daydream about destroying everything. Like taking a sledgehammer to like old Greek marbles, just going nuts. Basically like the Joker in 1989.
You should watch Last Man on Earth. That's pretty much half that show.
That's true. But I want a VR game where you just have a sledgehammer or like a jackhammer, anything you want. And it's like, you have 5 minutes in this famous museum, go and just destroy as much as you possibly can. Basically like the Saints Row, what's that called? The insurance fraud thing.
Oh, right. Yeah. Love
just
it.
Just draw as many mustaches on these paintings as you can.
Wouldn't that be great?
That's fun.
That is a great idea.
Dangerous Golf.
Yeah.
You might have something like that, like a museum level or something, where you just try to break as much as you can within
it's
the
similar,
room.
Similar, but I want to like slowly dismantle some old statues or just destroy this thing that's 5,000 years
Monet
old.
Monet gallery and just go nuts.
I thought of another scary game.
Yeah.
Being swallowed and digested.
What the hell?
I'm thinking things
by like a giant human. Or
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Okay. So the very beginning of the game, it's like losing the boss fight in Final Fantasy that we talk about, where it's just the very beginning, you're like, oh, you're just eaten, and then the rest is you being pumped through a system as you come out
in
of
fact,
butt.
You know, I saw Pinocchio. It's not that bad.
You know what I like actually is a game.
A moist basement
is a game where that's like the kicker. But you think it's a different game. You think it's like a narrative indie relationship building game. And instead, you and all your friends get eaten at the very end and it's you watch like, them get like masticated. And
but
then
it feels
you're
like Attack
digesting.
On Titan.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, it'd be tough because like the toughest thing I'd imagine about getting eaten other than the teeth is like not having air. So like trying to stimulate that suffocation might be tough, but just like being in the confined space of like undulating weird red flesh. That's what's going to do it for
you. Yeah.
You realize some people are super into it. It's called a vor fetish, right? Specifically the Brian Vor fetish. Brian Vor, former Game Informer, told us all about it.
Yeah, Brian, Vor told us about voring.
His real last name is Thompson, but he's such a crazy Vor fetishist that he changed his last name. All right, what do you guys think? What's your favorite email for the week?
We really dug into that last one.
It's good.
The scary game one, yeah.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, there we go. So VR game creation idea. Chase Smith, you are the email of the week. Congratulations.
Yeah, nice.
And
good question.
We'll send you out something real nice. And to hear more about VR, you can stay tuned for the Lorne Lanning interview, which is coming up, because he's an awesome guy that's been in the industry for so long. He swears about 16,000 times He has some very bold opinions on VR and the amount of, quote, dumb BS money that's floating around that's damaging and BS. Wow. So it's an interesting conversation, but stay tuned if you want to
brilliant stuff
hear about the kind of intersection between film and the game world and the future of Oddworld, all that fun stuff. So
and BS.
And BS. So stay tuned for that. Lauren Lanning, welcome to the Gameformer Show, sir.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's great to be here, Ben.
No, it's a real honor to have you, man. I've wanted to talk to you forever. I've been at Gameformer for like 5 years, and the first Oddworld was very important to me. So thank you for your work on that, man.
Oh, it's my pleasure, man. Hey, thank you. The team did a good job, so you know I'm always proud of that.
Yeah. So you just want to set the lay of the land. What's going on with you these days? What's happening over there?
Well, as you can tell by my hair, man, I'm just getting older at an accelerated rate, it appears. So trying to manage that is new, but hopefully we're successful in the process. And then beyond that, you know, of course, we're working on the next title.
Yeah, which is the remake of
it's called Oddworld Stories. Well, sort of. So if we were to put this in comparison to New and Tasty, we looked at the following way, which was we said, you know what? The script of New and Tasty was sort of like that, almost like that mature nursery rhyme that we wanted it to be. It was told in rhyme. It was different things. But it really sort of, as an arc, we went, you know what? For that classic, time has treated it well. Let's keep the script. And we were thinking about it, like, what happens in Hollywood when they remake a movie? Why the remakes we almost never like as much as the original? And one of my favorite films of all time was Time Machine, you know, the original film.
Okay.
Which was, you know, I used to have a poster right in front of me, but I think it was like 1950s or so, okay. 60s or something. And 60-ish. Forgive me, I'm wrong, so forgive me.
Don't worry about it. I've never even seen it, so you can do no wrong.
Oh, man.
I know. I read the book. I enjoyed the book when I read it as a kid, but I never seen the movie.
Let me ask you. You've seen Star Wars, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You've seen Lord of the Rings, right?
Yeah.
Okay, man. You haven't seen Time Machine? Like, what do you
put it up there with those two?
Yeah, man. This is serious. You gotta check it out. It's Wells, right? So, anyways, one of my favorite movies of all time. And then I think it was Tim Burton remade it later, and it was just, you know, it wasn't at all in the same capacity.
Right? Sure.
And we see that occasionally with films. And we were like, hey, why didn't they just remake Time Machine with the same script? The script was great. Why didn't they just remake it with 21st century technology? That would be mind blowing, right? Forbidden Planet, same thing. Just keep the same script, you know. Yeah. The Day the Earth Stood Still. Just keep the same script, and it could be great. So, although they did do a pretty good job on The Day the Earth Stood Still.
That was okay. Yeah, Keanu.
They had Keanu, which is like, okay. But what's his name in The Matrix? Neo. You know, so Neo saves the day in as the alien. But to the point and to your question was, on remaking Abe's Odyssey, we said, look, it's not just in HD. We're going to totally redo it with 21st century technology, but we want to keep the script the same, and we want to learn from 20 years of game design since. So how do we improve it but keep the heart and keep the script the same? That was our mandate internally for New and Tasty. And for Exodus, Exodus had a different beginning. And long story short, Exodus happened in a situation where we had delivered a hit for the publisher, and our plan was to sort of take, you know, probably another 2 years. And I'm not saying it was a smart plan, but it was probably taking another 2 years on the next title. What happened was we were one of the few titles that delivered for them that Christmas. And this was a GT Interactive. And it was a new big, you know, a new big hope of game publishers.
Okay.
And so they were going after things really aggressively. But what happened is a few of the other titles slipped at Christmas and completely hammered this company's public stock value. But we made it on time and we gave them a hit. So, of course, that put us in a bad spot because now they're saying, we need your next game for next Christmas. And you're the guys that came through for us, so you have to do it. And at the time, you know, they owned about half the company. So just being good partners, you know, this is life and business, right? So you got to play. But what that meant was we had to get done a title in 9 months, and the previous one took us over 2.5 years. So that was a big challenge. And what that meant was we had to scream through the script. And the end of the story is, so instead of being like, are we happy with this script and are we going to move forward in development? It was more like, you got a week and a half to get the script signed off because we have to move into development, which is a problem I call sequelitis.
Sure.
Right. Meaning, why is it that the things that we see in movies and stuff, the sequels is rarely as good as the original, but, you know, sales might be twice, something like that. But rarely does it have the same heart. And the reason is usually time pressure to get to market, and then the business changes. You know, The Matrix 2 was not The Matrix 1. And The Matrix 1 was better, but it only had about a tenth of the budget. I'm exaggerating there, but it was much smaller budget.
Right.
And so in our case, we built Exodus, and the team did a great job. We did it. It was a Herculean task that was done in 9 months. But what it meant was the script was not necessarily sort of the heart of what we wanted to communicate. And time and circumstances, you know, got us there. So now when we look back, and we had polled the audience before we started, when we announced that we were making New and Tasty, we said, what do you want us to make next? And this is our core fan base who we listen to.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter how brutal it can be sometimes, you know, you're like, oh, my God. You know, okay, they're really upset. But we listen. And what they said was, we want to see Exodus done. If you do a good job on New and Tasty, we want to see Exodus done that way, too.
Is this just like tweets, like responding to the Twitter post? Yeah, do you have like a poll on the site? Or what exactly
poll,
is it?
Poll Facebook, poll our website, forums. Okay. And that's what we would do. We would poll the forums. So Facebook and like that. And people get, you know, so you set up a poll and people like polls. I like polls. But anyhow, then we get, you know, we get thousands of responses and we have a better idea of where the herd is. And we said, look, you know, new titles from Oddworld are kind of more expensive than we can afford yet. And we like the independence that we have now. So if you'll support us on the budget, you know, meaning we're budget, then you know, what game would you like to see? And so new games, people are like, we want to see Fangus, or we want to see Stranger 2, or we want to see a brand new game. And we'd be like, well, that's really nice, and they're more expensive than we can afford. But what if we could, like, here's a slew of titles. And even with some of those new titles, people were like, do it to Exodus. Like, do a great job on Exodus. And a lot of people loved Exodus.
Yeah.
So we went, okay, but now let us assess that internally. And internally we said, we want to make the script of it. The story that inspired the sort of mythos, the high concept of what inspired Exodus, we really liked.
And what was but, that?
That it involved Soulstorm Brew, the brewery. It involved a brewmaster who was the new, like, Gluckin, you know, antagonist in the whole thing. And it was really a fable where part two of, in part one, the slaves wake up and realize they're slaves to a big industrial mechanism, to a company. They're not what they thought they were. So they wake up to the idea they're actually slaves. And they wake up to the idea that they're doomed. And what happens is they free themselves of this, and Abe's the catalyst. They free themselves of this oppression. And Abe's Exodus was about, and now the slaves start to realize, this was at the heart of it, the slaves start to realize that they are slaves to their own addictions and habits, and they're played that way as well. So they don't need to be directly employed, but they can be directly manipulated through consumer products, through addictions, through things like that.
Light theme. Really, really lighthearted for the kids out there.
Yeah, you know, we figure, like, that's some really good childhood topic stuff. The light fare for the family. So that was at the core of it. And you know, I mean, Oddworld has never been something where you walk away and a marketing department goes, if someone would just build a game about genocidal, you know, Soylent Green type, you know, content, we think it'd be a big hit today. I mean, it is not where we get our ideas from, right? It's not the marketing department saying, we think we could sell this. We're like, nah, this is crazy. But what we do believe is this resonates more relevantly to the audience, and this is not things they're getting in a lot of what they're eating.
Yeah.
So media diet.
So the idea is it's kind of a reboot of the Exodus concept. Is that how you describe Soulstorm, the new one?
So I have rewritten Exodus, and it's no longer Exodus, but it's inspired by the Exodus story. And then what we're using is we're using that as the spine, and we're using the gameplay flow as the spine to inspire this title. And the title is still about a brewery. It's still about brew. And it's still about Abe having just freed the slaves of Rupture Farms, and now having to bring basically an exodus about, which is why it was named Exodus, was really the freeing of the slaves and following their leader, right?
So is it just the idea that you want to kind of appease both camps and both worlds?
No, it's less of that, and it's more of what makes a great title.
Sure.
So what we're saying is we're going, okay, we're listening, we hear your feedback, we appreciate what you're saying, but if we're going to go remake Exodus, which was a big story and a big game, we're going to make it what it was originally intended to be, not what we got done in 9 months. And it starts with the script.
That's really interesting. So,
at a very practical level, which I think you'd appreciate, you know, a Game Informer likes to get into the development of things, right? Yeah. Like, why did you make these decisions? At a very practical level, a lot of time is spent on developing each of the puzzles, spent on layout, spent on developing mechanics, you know, these types of things. And so by being inspired by the original story of Exodus, but it's a complete retake. However, a lot of the puzzles, a lot of the layouts, you'll notice, you'll be like, oh, this is where the original is kind of, you know. So there will be this fact of like, I'm watching something completely new, but it's clearly inspired by this original.
But the level of fidelity that was in New and Tasty, is that what you guys are shooting for?
It would be better.
Better?
Significantly.
Yeah. But it is a different development studio, right? Because you were working with Just Ed Lauder for so long.
That's right. However, that is true. But what that also means is that the new development studio, we have more resources. It's closer to home. We're actively involved full time on this production. Me personally, and Benny Terry, and other people, Michael Bross, who was the original composer on Munch and Stranger, Raymond Swanland, who's the original designer of from Abe's Exodus. He was a background artist to Stranger's Wrath. He was the key artist designing Stranger and other characters, and he went on to since become like, you know, really world famous illustrator. His recent properties being Star Wars and Warhammer and Magic the Gathering cards, like Raymond Swanland, you know, pretty great talent. Yeah. So we're bringing back, some real seasoned Oddworld talent that made a big difference in our past. And we are co-developing this. So we are actively in the trench, myself personally, full time from beginning to end. New and Tasty didn't really go that way. New and Tasty was kind of on autopilot at Jaw. And then I came in the last 9 months and we wrapped it up.
Just because that was a more faithful remake?
It was a more faithful remake, and we didn't realize how much exposure New and Tasty was actually going to get. That's the truth. So we had one budget on it originally, and we thought it was going to cost this much. It wound up costing us that much, right? That's pretty accurate. And at least four times more than we expected, and we're self-financed, so it was very difficult. But we got something done basically with our focus over the last 9 months on a 3-year development. And in this one, we'll be involved with the development the entire time, and we're shooting for, you know, inside of a 2-year release. Nice. And inside of. And but we're not given a firm date yet because that would be dumb.
Right.
And now we hit the ground running with the engine that exists for New and Tasty, which was a ton of work to get Unity to deliver Unity and Tasty. And I don't mean that as Unity a corporation. I just mean the Unity as a company was actually surprisingly responsive and supportive to requests that we had in their core animation system, core lighting, core shaders. There's a lot of different requests. We go, look, guys, with the way this is being done, you can't get this type of an effect. With the way that's being done, you can't get this type of animation, you know, fidelity. And I really give to their credit a few years ago. You know, it's totally different management now. I don't know how it'll go. But a few years ago, when Dave, I always say his name wrong. I'm not very good at the Scandinavian pronunciations, but I want to say Hevold's son. Well, how do you say his name? You know, CEO, the original founder of Unity. But anyway, nothing but kudos to him.
Yeah.
That entity, because they recognized that requests that we were making made Unity look better, and they implemented them, which is really rare for a successful software company to do.
So you're pretty happy with the engine overall. I know, like, I think
for this type of game. I mean, we had our headaches going to multi SKUs. There's always some sort of compromises when you use middleware instead of bacon.
Well, it's interesting. Like, I think, like, when Firewatch came out recently, there's kind of a wave of realization amongst people to be like, hey, Unity on PS4 and consoles in general, like maybe specifically just for 3D games, because I think I remember New and Tasty running pretty well. They say like, it's not running that great. Do you think Unity is having a tough time on the consoles for some reason? Do you have any insight into why that is?
Well, what I think is that it all depends on what you're trying to do, right? If we were making a really simple light, like what was Unity's, you know, basically one button and you get all the SKUs, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe that's sort of true if you have a really light mobile game that utilizes the best capability of the lowest end performing device, and then you can go to PS4, Xbox One, Wii U, Vita, mobile, no problem, right? Because you got a very light, super light game that's not using any of the capabilities of those higher systems. But if you were approach it the way we did, which is let's try and max out Unity's capability on the PS4. And I'm not saying all capabilities, but you know, for the type of game we were making, we didn't do multiplayer, we didn't do other things. But if we try to max out the capabilities on US4, then let's have a really hard time getting the other every other SKU, because now you're scaling back, you know. So if you're scaling up, it's easy. If you're scaling down, it's hard.
Okay.
So that's really a developer decision. You know, I can't hold Unity responsible for those calls. But yeah, that's what we did, and that made it a lot harder. Now, in the case of Firewatch, I was actually I was at an event and sat next to the creator of that,
Sean Vanneman.
We're talking a lot. Yeah, great guy.
Yeah, for sure. He's been on the show.
Really love where they're coming from. And big supporter of what they're doing. Well, at least in spirit. You know, it's like saying I support the troops, but you know, I haven't coughed up a dime for anything. But but in their case, what they were trying to do, and what you'll notice is different, what they were trying to do is they were getting like, they weren't having level loaded rooms. They were trying to put you on an open world atmosphere that felt more like Unreal 4, right? And in terms of, wow, I look in the distance, I see woods way off there, and I can actually go there, and I don't have these big, you know, it's not like I got to go through a tunnel repeatedly to have a cashing in and cash out of a level management. So they tried to do something, I think, that was very ambitious for Unity. And in that respect, they succeeded quite well. And so in my personal opinion, and this is just interesting because I think they're interesting and I think their approach is interesting, is that by releasing a title like that, doing it the first time, no matter what they – so they learned a lot. They did – financially, they did really well. And in that, you know, they may make different choices of engines in the future for different reasons, but it's really smart stuff that they're doing. So they push Unity in a way where they were trying to push environment and distance in natural environments further than I've ever seen Unity push. They told me than they've ever seen Unity push. And so I think that accounts for a lot of the performance challenges that people might identify.
Gotcha. So I'm curious just what life has been like for you. You've been working in the Oddworld universe for 20 years. I mean, have you kind of had like a Guns N' Roses arc where you wanted to break away for a long time, and now with New and Tasty, it's like you're getting back on the road?
It was called 2005 to about 2009, 2010, really.
Was that liberating for you to get away for a little while? I mean, were you still jotting down ideas?
Yeah, because I wanted to try some other things, and we did, and we went and we got a film deal. And so we got a film deal in 2007, that turned into an economic financial crisis in 2008 for the planet. And so we had a film development deal on new property that was actually greenlight by a big AAA publisher as one of their big bets for the PS2 generation. I'm sorry, PS3 generation. And we walked from that at that time because we were just sick of the way the publisher-developer relationships were going, and we didn't want to lose our IP over time. So we just went, you know, why are we doing this? Let's mm-hmm. just wait, and let's have the hope that digital distribution will let us eventually go directly to the customer and get away from this retail, dysfunctional retail publisher-developer relationships that basically, you know, are the legacy of the game business through the 90s and the early 2000s and stuff mm-hmm. that basically ate up, you know, all the small developers, mid-tier developers. Either acquisitions or out of business, right?
Do you feel like the world's changed enough where you're really happy with the situation?
Yeah, huge. And but we went on to do a couple different things and then stuff, like just to say, the CG film was rated R, CG animated.
Was this Citizen Siege?
Citizen Siege.
Okay, yeah.
And the fact was, we figured out that with the financial crisis, no one was going to. At the end of the day, the chances that we'd be able to release a $60 million movie rated R and CG, and people that are now fiscally like risk averse, we're gonna continue to support. So we just went, timing's bad mm-hmm. for trying to push a rated R CG film. And I think we're seeing it coming up with, I just met with these people the other day, Annapurna Pictures, with Sausage Party.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Who's working on that again?
It's Annapurna Pictures. Okay. It's, the studio that's behind it, you know, but it's just, I mean, Sausage Party, you're like, what are you kidding me? It's going to be rated R animated CG.
Is it like Jonah Hill and stuff behind that one?
Huge. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. 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 Jonah Hill. Yeah.
Okay.
And whoever else. And, but basically that crowd is the script writers and the voices. So they had, you know, 50 million plus views as a trailer. You know, they're on their way to a huge success. But the beauty of that is they'll prevail rated R CG in the way that Deadpool
yeah.
just prevailed rated R, you know, comic book movie.
So you're saying you're hoping that opens a door for Citizen Siege to come back?
It's possible. I wrote Citizen Siege in 2005, 2006. Is when we, particularly me and Raymond Swanland and stuff, were plotting out Citizen Siege. And I'm not exactly sure that that's the story I want to tell in the world today. The world's changed a little bit. And it's intense, man. It's dark and intense. And Oddworld's already dark and intense, but Citizen Siege is just like f***ed up. So I love it, but I'm not exactly sure. And it's a big thing. It's a big project. And so it was greenlit as a AAA project, and it was in development as a motion picture. So it's a, you know, we still retain all the rights to it and stuff. But right now I feel like Oddworld's the most relevant to the times. And it's also very difficult to launch a new IP today. So with Oddworld, there's actually people voraciously yelling at us for more content. And we're kind of dumb to leave that sitting on the table when the time is right. And the time is right in a lot of ways. It's right. We became fully independent. If you think in 2005, we made a big, hard choice, which is we shut down a studio. We laid off, you know, a lot of people lost their jobs. And we went, hey, man, we're not willing to give it all up under these time and circumstances with these types of relationships. And neither should you be. You know? So I think we always had good blood. No matter what happened in Oddworld with the employees, I hear all the time people say, you know, that was still like my best gig in the gaming industry. I'm still the most proud of that work. Like, I hear that a lot. But these guys went on, like Ryan Ellis went on. He's head of the art department at Bungie now.
Yeah, yeah.
These guys went down to Blizzard. They went to Sony, Santa Monica. You know, they're all over the industry in great places. And just talent-wise speaking, I guess I'm going to the kudos of the team.
Yeah.
That was team that worked on Exodus, right? And what's funny is we get those guys' support even though they're not doing, you know, that much. And what you'll notice is we'll, like in New and Tasty, we put all the original team's names in the credits as
well.
So these are just things people don't do as practices. And I should say publishers don't do as practices in the industry. But as indie, who gives a shit? Give people credit if they did something. I mean, I worked on movies that my name is not on. You know, and that was the way Hollywood works. You're not union. It took forever for effects people to be listed in motion pictures. You know, the hand model shows up and they get into People magazine, and the effects people were like, they don't even broadcast their Academy Awards on TV. They do it, you know, it's not even, the audience didn't care to watch, right?
Yeah. So walking between those two worlds, between Hollywood and the gaming industry, what do you think, how are things recently? How have things changed in the last couple of years? Are there any trends popping up that really interest you?
Yeah. There's a lot, and so just staying away from all the like VR hype and stuff like that for the moment. And what that's doing is it's actually tying Hollywood and games more together again, except not in the cheesy branded low quality game release way. But Hollywood gets that this is a new medium, and so first, let me say, in the landscape of VR, just why not say it, is there's more fraud going on than I've ever seen in the business. I'm not going to name specific things, but there's more bullshit. There's more absolute bullshit being sold to investors across the planet. And what's changed a lot is now you've got investors coming from different territories, and they're very culturally different types of investors. So you got a lot of China, you got Russia, you got Brazil, South America, India. These are places where, you know, people are becoming billionaires and they want to get into media exportation businesses and entertainment businesses and things like this, get their money out of countries. There's all kinds of shit going on. And everyone who has basically had a failing operation, whether it was in games or in film or in theme parks, now they're the VR experts in the world and they're going to solve your problems with VR. And it's like, holy shit. It's like con men, conning, con men, conning, con men. I've seen a ton of it. I'm not going to mention any specifics, but I haven't seen it like this since the rocket science days. Remember in the beginning when I don't know if you remember, but before, were you around when the 3DO came out?
I mean, I was a kid. Sorry.
Yeah, okay. So there was all this hype back then. Oh, Silicon and Hollywood and Silicon Valley and Hollywood are going to connect, and there's going to be, you know, the World Wide Web is coming, and we're going to be streaming movies, and all this shit was being talked about in, you know, like 92, 93. And that's actually when we got the money, because I realized there was a lot of dumb money getting poured into the video game space. And I was like, well, anyone who knows what they're doing shouldn't be investing in us. Right? Really? Because we don't know what we're really doing. So right. We just have a good story and a good hope and a lot of will to make it happen. But if you're looking for, you know, who's done this before and who's made hits and games, you know, we were the wrong people to look at. But because all that sort of dumb money was floating in, I was like, this is our chance to get in, you know, 92 to 94. So we started putting together business plans to get in and get the money to start Oddworld. And so I haven't seen it since that time, where a lot of people were just being hoodwinked into solutions that didn't exist.
So is this dumb money being thrown around? I mean, does it hurt developers then ultimately? Is it just, or is it only a boon for them for a little while?
No, I think it's going to hurt investors.
Okay.
And I think what will happen is you'll have the typical, you know, developers or other entities that are impersonating developers. Not to be underestimated right now in terms of the quantity of this. There are a lot of people that claim to be developers, entities, and they really don't have any history of developing software. But they might have a history in some other sector and not say, oh, you know, VR, and you're in China, and you need a VR solution, and, you know, we're in California, and blah, 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 and it's just bullshit. You know, so there's going to be a lot of lawsuits eventually.
So they just want to be the middlemen between this possible new trend and an actual developer?
No, they just want to survive, man. This is just capitalism, right? Like, what happens is you have companies that aren't working out. They've failed they failed as a mobile company. They failed as this, they failed as that, whatever. They're just struggling. They're constantly there. And now they see all this dumb money flowing into VR. And so let's become the VR experts, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got people showing demos that aren't theirs, right?
So what do you think? I mean, 5 years from now, what do you think the VR industry is going to look like?
It's a little hard to predict because VR is going – first of all, VR is not going away, right? It's not going away.
It's got Facebook money. It's not going away.
And Facebook's going to be the slowest player to succeed. Right? Facebook, I mean, that was the most overvalued buy in history. Seriously.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not giving – hey, good – more power to everybody. But $2 billion for a demo. There's other things going on. There's other things going on that motivated that aren't just like, oh, this is going to be huge and this is going to be the system to do it. There's another reason I think Facebook to pay $2 billion for it. And it's not one I'll mention because it's theoretical. You know, it doesn't make sense. It never made sense unless you're coming at it from a completely different angle. But I can give you my forecast of what I think is going to happen in VR.
Hang on, is it more of a conspiracy angle you're talking about?
Well,
something
no,
with, as
no,
far as
no.
data?
Just pure business, but not necessarily business being talked about.
Okay.
Right? And if you just look, Facebook versus, let's take one possibility. Facebook versus Google. You're hiring people in Silicon Valley. Which company do you want to work for? You're a $200,000 a year programmer. Which company do you want to work for?
Probably go Google.
Yeah, you're going to go Google, right? Because they got a million interesting things and scientists and problems that they're solving across the world. Who knows? They're going to be driving automated cars. They're going to be putting ships in space. They're going to be redefining exploration in every way, shape, and form through maps. I mean, right?
Yeah.
I know scientists that figure out that other countries have illegal toxicity dumping problems, and they're identifying those problems on Google Earth, right? So Facebook is different. So Facebook's company figured out how to become an ultimate connector and promo audience. But if you were a real cutting edge programmer, do you want to go to Facebook? Right. Or what's their future? Mm-hmm. But now that they own Facebook, now that they own Oculus, maybe you want to go to Facebook.
So it's a recruiting tool to look cool. Is that the basic idea?
I've heard some people say that. I think there's some validity to it. Paying $2 billion for it is another like, there's obviously something more going on. And I don't think Zuckerberg's a naive guy, right? So something's more going on because it doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. However, what it did was it made everyone else say, this is real if Facebook's paying $2 billion. That was the main catalyst, right? That's the thing that got everyone to go, oh, Zuckerberg's a genius. You know, he's the new Bill Gates. He's the new Steve Jobs. Must be something there. Let's rush in. And the fact is that if you get a good demonstration of VR today, whether it's a Valve demonstration, whether it's a Oculus demonstration, even if it's a Sony demonstration, you're sold. Mm-hmm. You're sold. You see a good one, you're sold. And so so that effect is very powerful. The VR effect, you know, when you can stand on a ledge of a building and you can't step forward and you know that you're on a safe floor in front of you and your primal fears are that deep, where all of a sudden crossing a little narrow ridge is no longer just a jump in a platformer game, but you're shitting your pants. And I with the mild fear of heights, I mean, I got a little Native American blood and we're supposed to be the best at the heights. Apparently I didn't get that gene because it's like, man, high heights, it a little freaked me out.
Well, I mean, I'll tell
you, nothing does it like VR and freak you out.
I mean, you talk about, being scared of heights, and that's interesting. Also, like, you think of like Zemeckis with The Walk, isn't that the name of the movie? Where that was a big push for them. They had the VR experience.
Example, right?
Yeah.
Did you see the video that the company cut together a trailer where they showed live action people, you know, real people doing it in an empty room, and then they're compositing it over The Walk?
Oh, no, I didn't see
that. Tom Hamm, if you search his name, you'll find the name of the company, and on their site, you'll find the name of the. He's a journalist. He used to be with TV Guide, stuff like that. Really great guy, but the entity he's a part of put together a videotape that I think is the best thing going to sell VR to people who haven't experienced VR. It's just an amazing watching how they did The Walk, and it's really excellent. You can see it; it's on their site. But do I think Zemeckis is going to be the guy who's building the best VR? Absolutely not.
Right.
You know, just like I don't expect Zemeckis or Spielberg or Lucas or any other guys to build any hit games. Right. However, when it starts crossing a line of how can a little VR experience help sell a movie, I think they're going to do a damn good job creating basically VR experiences that are commercials.
Yeah, right? It makes for a good headline at least. Like, hey, check out this crazy thing in VR.
Yeah, and what's Hollywood's problem? You know, they can't get people in the theater.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, not can't. We have record-breaking numbers, but it's always a challenge. And it's always more and more expensive, and ticket prices are not getting cheaper, and theaters are having to offer more, nicer seats, drinks, you know, dining while you're at the movie. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you go to the nice ones in L.A., it's like, wow, man, this feels like, you know, what kings and queens must have had when they went to the opera.
And now you hear all of...
It's really going off.
Yeah, you hear so much about, like, the divide in Hollywood, too, with, what's it called, the screening room? The theoretical tech where it'll just you can get new movies for a certain subscription price, and it seems like directors are split down the middle between absolutely hating this idea of stabbing theaters in the back versus being all for it. So,
well, you know, the thing about film directors that I've learned is very few of them are actually good business people. Right. And it's like rock and roll stars. Very few of them are actually good business people. You know, the chairman of Oddworld today, Sharon McKenna, who was my partner, who I was lucky enough to get her to be my boss. And that's the fact. Like, this was a legendary producer in Hollywood computer graphics and visual effects. But she used to do things with all kinds of talent, you know, Michael Jackson, Mick Jagger, like that, shooting music videos. I mean, she's worked with them all, right? And for an example, Mick Jagger is a brilliant business guy.
Okay.
So Mick Jagger's degree is in economics. And I think it's from London School of Economics or something like that, if it's not as Oxford or something that's ridiculously brainiac, you know, Ivy League-ish class. And and then you have people like, you know, David Lee Roth, right? Or MC Hammer, where, you know, they make millions of dollars and now they're broke. Whereas Mick Jagger will never be broke. When he's on a set and you were shooting something and they're on the video, you know, she's like, all he wanted to talk about was Wall Street Journal and what investments and how stock prices were changing and which currencies he should short. I mean, he's a smart dude, man.
So what do you think about like film directors business-wise versus game directors?
Film directors are more like rock stars. And it's more like, hey, I'm the and the smart ones, let's say smart business film directors. I'm not a fan of his films, We went to school at the same time, same place, but is Michael Bay, right? Michael Bay is a very smart businessman when it comes to film directing, I'll tell you why. It doesn't mean he makes films I want to watch, but he knows exactly what his audience is. He'll go, so shoot me. I make films for 14, 15-year-old boys. Kill me.
I've got a job, yeah.
And he knows exactly. That's who's buying movie tickets mostly. He's making date movies for boys. And and he cleans up. He knows exactly what he's doing. And he can go make that argument. And he can continue to get more money because it makes sense. And, you know, an old guy who was a brilliant filmmaker was, I should say businessman, was Roger Corman. Right? And if you're familiar with the Roger Corman films, he figured out that for $10, I can make $100. Yeah. And so he just stuck to a model, and he was very. Another guy in a different way is and I just got to notice I got more time if you do.
Yeah, for sure.
Another guy in a different way is Martin Scorsese. Now, Martin Scorsese, they would say, was always jealous of the success of Steven Spielberg. And Steven Spielberg was always jealous of the film auteur recognition that Martin Scorsese got. However, Scorsese was smart enough that he realized he wasn't making blockbuster hits, and he never would. What he was doing was he was making movies for a certain audience, and he could depend on that scale of an audience to come see his movies. And the studios were constantly trying to get him because these studios are so out of touch. And this is this I say with confidence, so out of touch with that they measure the success of a movie is largely going to be dependent on the budget of the movie. So they're always trying to encourage Scorsese to make a more expensive movie. And he's going, I don't want to make a more expensive movie. Because if I make a more expensive movie, I'm going to lose. Meaning it's not going to be profitable.
Yeah.
And I know that only this many people like my movies. I have no illusions. I'm not Steven Spielberg. I'm not Michael Bay. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to get that many people to see my movie. Now, I might get an Academy Award. That's different, right? I'll be expected. The critics might love it, but I'm not going to have a blockbuster summer hit, right? So don't try and make me spend more than this much money on the movie.
Do you ever see that in do you ever see that in the game industry? People trying to up the budget just because it'll be easier to sell?
No.
We're too thrifty.
Yeah, I think the games are too easy to escalate into just a, you know, we've failed zone.
So you talked about, like, you know, the smart businessmen in music and film. Who are the smartest businessmen in games? Like, who are you looking up to?
Well, you know, I mean, I think that a lot of the cases are pretty obvious. You know, there's Jason Rubin with Naughty Dog and Andy Gavin and what they pulled off. There's Ray and, you know, BioWare.
Yeah.
Greg, right? Ray, mm-hmm. Greg. We're really... I mean, those guys were medical doctors, and they figured out they wanted to make games, and then they figured out how to become really stinking rich. So good for them, and they did it doing quality. Both companies did it making quality product. So
and now Jason gets the double payday of Oculus now.
Maybe, right? Like, that's got to pay off still.
Right.
You know, if you were there at Oculus before Facebook bought, I'm sure, you know, you're as lucky as lucky, right? But if you came in afterwards, I think, you know, now you got to have the success that makes back that purchase price where you can really profit. I'm sure, I don't know the ins and outs of these guys' deals, but I'm sure if Jason was interested enough to go take a job, and that dude does not need to take a job, right? But if he's interested enough to take a job, you can bet he has really good business advisors. And his father's a great attorney. And so when I will always pay attention to moves that Jason Rubin makes.
Interesting. Okay. It's interesting to think of, like, Hollywood, going back to your previous point about, like, Call of Duty announcing, like, hey, we want to make Call of Duty cinematic universe. Mm-hmm. And I think about that in terms of the Oddworld games, where I feel like you guys were really ahead of the curve in seeing the potential of having a shared universe in media. Do you want to talk about... Does it feel like the rest of the world is catching up to you guys in the Oddworld?
Well, it's hard for me to look at it that way, to give you an honest answer, but I look at it this way. We got into games because we saw the opportunity that we could bring deeper character development, better cinematics capabilities, manage large teams more efficiently because we've had that experience in the past on films, managing several hundred person teams. So when I look at it, sorry, I'm skipping on your question a second.
I was talking about the shared universe, having that as
So the idea is that it's basically a transmedia idea, right? That you build a property, it's rich enough that it can transcend different media types. And so we go, Dr. Seuss did it, the Peanuts did it, Disney did it. You know, like some things that started as storybooks became huge. Look at Harry Potter, right?
Yeah.
And so at the time when we started Games, publishers didn't value sequels. I've said this more and more recently, but it's hard to get your head around to say publishers did not believe in sequels. And this was one of the aha moments that I had for the game industry. I was like, my God, the future is all going to be about brand. And they don't get the value of brand. They were still thinking about it in the early 90s, like the toy industry was thinking, which is, well, you have a hit, and then you know, you milk it for all it's worth. But when you make the second one, you're only going to at most sell half as many. So there, that, I mean, when I would say, look, we're building a universe and we're going to be saving digital backlots and we're going to have the ability to do television shows and movies and all these things off the shared assets. And how it would be just like, it never works out that way. And the game industry was like, there's no money in sequels, right? No money in sequels.
Why
man.
Would they say that? I mean, there were plenty of sequels back in the day, right?
Nope. Go back. Nope.
What era are we talking about? Early 90s?
Yeah, early 90s. So 94, when I started talking to publishers, raising money, and I'd bring up the argument that we were really building a transmedia universe, they go, there's nothing, sequels. We don't do sequels. And then you had the beginnings of like, Doom was so successful, they said, well, let's try Doom 2. Myst was so successful, well, let's try this. And what happened? They weren't as successful.
Right.
So if you go back and you look at, and these are the business guys, so they're just looking at, you know, what was the sales numbers? That's the only story they care about. What's the history of the sales numbers? And so they don't care about who fucked up bringing it to market. They don't care about what warehouse lost what goods that weren't on the shelf when you were running your TV commercials and wasting all that money. They don't care about all this stuff. They just look back at history and say, where's the numbers? And the numbers for them at that time were saying there's no real money in sequels. And you didn't have Hollywood guys getting in. And it was the beginning of Hollywood guys getting in. They were like, look, it's going to be about catalogs and brands because all entertainment is, it's only a question of time. Mm-hmm. It's all about brand familiarity. There's too much clutter out there. Got to cut through the audience. If they like something and you can say, Jaws 2, right? That was the beginning of movie sequels.
Right.
Right? The Godfather 2 was like, Coppola didn't want to make The Godfather 2. He was like, "We don't. What are you talking about? The studio's like, you got to make it, man. You got to make it. It's got to be great. We need a hit. You know, and people love The Godfather. That whole sequel idea, that didn't really start until Star Wars and Jaws. You know, Spielberg and Lucas changed film into sequel-driven summer blockbuster hits.
So how did the sequel work for you with Exodus? I mean, how were the sales compared to Odyssey back in the day?
They were half, and the reason was, well, I don't want to get into specifics of it, but the reasons had little to do with us. It had to do with the machine of getting to market, you know, getting disc pressed, getting making sure the people that are supposed to be your support groups, marketing, PR, stuff like that. Basically, those elements were fleeing the publisher at the time that we were releasing Exodus. So although we had a twice installed base, we had 1 million games in a warehouse. Lost as our commercials were running. So that's history. You know, it's not easy history to prove because you can't Google it, right? Mm-hmm. But that's just what happened. And so at different times, I was bitter about these kinds of things. But the fact is, it's just life and business, capitalism. You know, you got to suck it up and deal with it if you want to keep on playing.
Are you optimistic these days about the game industry?
Yeah, I am. Because here, let's look at what happened. You know, so we're going, those are old baggage stories.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
That's like, how did Exodus do? Half as much. So it validated the old models that people were still stuck on, except new heroes were emerging. And through those, the games became a sequel-driven business, right? Like they were starting to get it. You get into now Xbox, PS2, Xbox, PS3, Xbox 360. These generations, all of a sudden, games are starting to get higher fidelity, better script writers, character development, you know, better rendering. All of this brought more Hollywood to games, really.
Yeah.
But the difference, and this is something film directors didn't understand. They go, oh, well, what happened here? What happened there? I'd be like, you don't get it, man. And the film industry didn't understand. I said, you don't get it. Every 5 to 6 years in the game industry, all the theaters go away. And now it starts from zero again. Right? You just keep on building on the collective of theaters that are growing. You just get more theaters across the world that you can play your films in, and it never gets smaller. What now? Just imagine you flush them all and start over with a new console generation. And they're like, "What? That sounds crazy." And you're like, "Welcome to games, man. It's technology."
So, what do you think about the rumors of the PlayStation 4K and having a slightly upgradable Xbox? Do you think that's a likely future for the industry?
Yes, and this goes to your question on VR, which is, how's it going to be? What's it look like in 5 years? Well, the thing I'm pretty convinced about is that VR as a headset is going to change at a similar frequency to how fast cell phones change. It's not going to change. The headset is going to be upgraded at a rapid rate. I would say most companies making them are going to be selling new, better ones, just like you go from iPhone 6 to iPhone 7 or whatever. They're going to be selling new, better ones about every 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Consoles is typically 6 years, right? 5 to 7 years. So now maybe, and I asked Shu Yoshida at DICE. Actually, I interviewed Shu Yoshida on the stage at DICE in 2015.
Yeah, it was a great video.
Oh, thanks. And who I have tremendous respect for. And I asked Shu a question. We didn't have time to ask it on stage, but I asked him this at dinner a few nights before. I said, well, what does the PlayStation 5 look like? And he said, you mean if? And I was like, whoa. I was like, are you willing to say that on the stage? And he goes, yeah, it's an if, right?
Even though PS4 is like dominating sales at that point?
It was a really interesting thing. He didn't give me a clear answer, but he's hinting at we need to be more agile. None of us know what the future really looks like. So how do we adapt to it faster? To me, that's the way he was sort of thinking about it, which I think is the right way to think about it. And the idea that you're going to release a piece of technology that lasts for 7 years into the future is becoming more and more, I think is less and less viable, even though the generations of platforms are lasting longer.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems like it's in conflict. But when you look at the generations of cell phones, and I'll give you an example. We're talking to some of the biggest cell phone, smartphone companies, and what do they want? They want us to be releasing our new PS4, Xbox One titles simultaneously on their latest high-capacity phones with almost the same image fidelity. So now what's going to happen is that mobile is just going to get powerful, 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 powerful. If you talk to Japan publishers, Square, they're releasing on mobile first, then they'll come to consoles later.
Right.
Not necessarily out of fidelity, but because that's where their audience is.
For sure. I mean, of like the business divisions in Japan, I think it's like 4 out of the 8 divisions within Square are developing mobile games. Like, it's gigantic.
Yeah. So Sony's clearly staying in the game business, and actually they'll be the first ones to win on VR. I have zero doubts about this. And the reason is they've already got the mechanisms to the plastic, the trucks going to the stores. They've already got the shelf space at the stores. They've already got PSN. They've got the... And I played some of the latest VR titles just a month or so ago of Sony's, and they are damn well good enough to sell and to get people buying them, I can guarantee you.
So there's less dumb money in the VR console industry?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Gotcha. Well, hey, I feel like we're running out of time. We should probably let you go, Lauren.
Okay. Anyway, I babbled, so sorry if I churned in.
No. I love it. You've been around for so long. I feel like I could keep you here for 6 hours, man. So maybe that's an upcoming podcast. Is just completely drain Lauren's mind.
All right.
Cool. But so Oddworld Soulstorm, what's the time frame? When can we look forward to that?
Yeah, Oddworld Soulstorm is coming. Within, our schedule is our production schedule is trying to hit and release within 2-year window.
Cool.
And but I can't get any more specific. That's our intent, but the fact of the matter is it needs to be great. And we don't like being late, but it needs to be great. So fingers crossed, we're going to stay on this one from beginning to end. We hope we're delivering something that's going to be not just what you would expect, but something a little more.
I'm excited to see something new from Oddworld. I think it's going to really start on that line.
Story take will be going there a bit. And then the whole goal of all of this is that we can basically increase the size of our funding capability and then hopefully hit the audience with a co-funding. Like, we'll match whatever. I'm not exactly sure, but crowdfunding is not out of the future. It's on the table for future possibilities as we truly go in and blaze 100% fresh new content.
So, I take it you're looking at FIG, stuff like that.
Yeah, those are all possibilities, you know, fake Kickstarter, et cetera. You know, we got to get there. We like not having financial partners. We like being able to make dumb decisions and live with the consequences. And we like being in control of our own destiny and not getting pressured into things that might not be good for the business. And so all those things are aligning quite well that we should be able to do a pretty good job on Soulstorm. And from there, we should have the resources to really launch into new content in a major way.
New Oddworld content.
Yeah. So hopefully, you know, everyone will support us and we make people happy and they don't want to crucify us.
Perfect. Well, we're excited to see what you do, man. But hey, thank you so much for joining us on the show.
Hey, thanks for having me, Ben. And thanks for having us. And anytime you want to continue the endless ramble of dialogue, you let us know.
I would love to. But thank you so much for watching or listening to this episode of the Game Informer Show. Be sure to tune in next week and we'll have a new episode waiting for you. Bye, everybody.
Okay, excellent.
So, Clank, we're supposed to do this podcast, Game Informer. Have you heard about this? Have you seen this?
Excuse me.
What? Yeah.
Ratchet, I'm watching my episode of Friends. Please, yeah. I rarely have any time to watch and catch up on these things.
Well, it's a lot more exciting than Game Informer, I'm telling you. No, honestly, I mean, I know we're not on yet, so it's really no big deal, but...
Game who?
I mean, we could go save the world, or we could do Game Informer. Let me choose. Save the world, save the universe, Game Informer. I guess we got to stick to Game Informer.
I'd rather watch Friends.